Welcome back, everyone, to the Archon Team League Championships. Trump came back exactly in time for the intro. So, you know, he's been casting with me earlier. We just saw a series between Team Celestial and Tempo Storm. Actually, that was a crazy series if you watched it. Tempo Storm was down 1-4 and then had a huge comeback, 6-4. And now Strifecore is going to be joining us as a player guest. How are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Woke up this morning, started watching the series. That's pretty good so far. I'm excited to see the next series and make some comments about it.
Yeah, I mean, these players are, you know, top of the line. I like the lineup from Team Liquid. Not their decks, of course, we haven't seen those. But Nerea is a player that I think is largely underrated. A lot of people who maybe follow the competitive scene might know the bigger names. But Nerea is kind of one of those that slips by some of the viewers sometimes, right? Because he might not be streaming nearly as much as some of the other names. Well, you know, like yourself, you know, Trump and Strifecrow. You're kind of known around the Hearthstone scene. But he's a really, really good player.
Yeah, I noticed how good he was when I guess the first time I really saw him play was in DreamHack. The one, I guess, like after BlizzCon last year, maybe DreamHack, the one in Sweden. I guess that's when I kind of noticed how good he was. I think he's really good. And I think he's been doing pretty good since
Yeah, he's
then.
Been doing well. Recently, yeah. He's been doing even better, in fact. So, before we move on to talking about the lineups for both teams, you know, in this best of 11, six decks each, we'll have the player spotlight featuring Zele. So, enjoy the video, guys. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Archon Zele. I was a Magic Online Player of the Year, and I was a State Chess Champion. As a Hearthstone player, right now I'm most known for playing Patron Warrior. I've been crushing it with that. I got like number one on NA, number two on EU on consecutive days. And I've just been playing it like crazy because that deck is just the most fun thing ever. I'm excited for the format of this team league. I think obviously Archon's going to crush it. Beyond that, I don't know, I'm looking forward to it. The strongest deck at the moment is Patron Warrior, and there's no counters to Patron Warrior. It's too OP. To all my fans, I love you. You're the best, and thanks for watching.
Right, so he seems to be pretty confident his team can take it. You know, Archon's definitely going to crush it. And so far, their standings are not necessarily that bad. They're 2 wins, 1 loss. And if they take today's lineup against Liquid, they're going to be 3-1. So again, they do have a chance to crush it. What are your thoughts on the team, Trump? I know you've been playing against the entire roster of players here.
Yeah, I mean, they're all strong players, of course. It is both teams have a really big incentive to win. Team Archon gets to 3-1. That would be a lead. Team Liquid wants to escape last place. The grasp.
Yeah, that's the one thing I think we mentioned. You know, Team Celestial needs Team Liquid to lose in order to have a chance to really come back in, right?
Have a better chance, at least, because the best record that Team Celestial can get right now is 3-4. So what they need is a team to, preferably a team that, I mean, their tiebreaker is also quite poor. So they need another team to stay to 2 wins. Team Liquid has the best chance of doing that just based off of record, not based off of the players. All of them are quite
good. Of course, yeah. Of course, yeah. You can't
really
make that call.
And nothing against like that last match, like they got the good matchup in Zoo versus Face Paladin, but Zoo drew the 7-drop and the 5-drop and then another 5-drop.
Yeah. So based on the lineups that we have here, we see that Shaman, Warlock, Warrior, and Mage are all common to both teams, but there's a hunter. I mean, actually, there's like a druid on Team Liquid side and a rogue on Team Archon side. My question is, two shamans, who expected that? Like, did you think that was going to happen in Strifecrow? Because I don't know how much faith most people put into the class.
Yeah, I'm not too expected if you look at, if you just don't actually research the teams and just look at the grand scheme of things. You know, some teams obviously do prefer shaman. Every team has like a different tendency for maybe like the 5th and 6th deck sometimes. I'm kind of surprised that, I mean, I've generally seen 5 of the same classes and like one kind of switch, you know, class that's kind of flex, but I think these, something is weird where they have like multiple flex classes in a way. So I guess like the metagame feels like it's changing a little bit. Right. I'm not sure about Archon or Liquid's tendencies about Shaman, so.
I think what it goes to show is that the quote-unquote core classes are close enough to the flex classes that you can't really consider the flex cards, the flex classes to be the flex classes. Mm-hmm. And in reality, they're all kind of close. And when you have so many decks to be up against, it turns out that Namek Shaman, perhaps Vanguarded by Kibler, turns out to be a really good match.
Yeah, I've thought like this recently. The game has been, I guess, like more balanced than ever. I mean, a lot of classes are like, you know, there's more viable classes than ever in Hearthstone, pretty much. So, like, there's like nothing, I guess, that's so much stronger. Even though it kind of feels like that sometimes, but people have gotten like very high legend rankings with pretty much every class by now. So,
yeah, the cycle is not nearly as bad as people say. So onto the game, we see that Savage is playing a probably mech shaman. I think Sixwell's picking up a probably typical rogue oil deck. So double mech warp opener, but there's no mech to follow it up at the moment. So even though it's not a bad hand, it's not necessarily what Savage wanted.
Yeah, rogue is a really good hand. This matchup is about tempo from the rogue's perspective. Once they get ahead on board, they're pretty much not going to lose it back to the mech shaman, and they start trading super efficiently. Having the SI and the like the manicure here, starting from SI next turn and Violet Teacher the turn after, is going to be really good. Especially if he draws another spell like with prep.
No, whoa.
We're going to have to use prep for the combo here. But like Strifegar said, it is all about tempo, and that is an example of using tempo.
Yeah, this might have been, this might as well have been a card that's called the nothing thing. It says do nothing, pay zero. Yeah, exactly. Oh my god, the Wisp would have been better. Is this a scenario of infinite value?
Infinite value? How come?
No, when you have a Wisp. Of course. It can't be infinite value without a Wisp. I thought you knew that, Strifegro.
No, I don't know what that means.
What? Zero mana, infinite you get stats? Value? You can't. Oh, you can't fathom Strifegro.
I cannot fathom it.
Well, Savich is still holding on to that board, though. I mean, he's curving into the Fire Elemental next turn and might get... Oh no, he's not going to get his 4-3-4 to live, unfortunately.
Yeah, the most important thing with that draw is that Savich has gotten tempo back. It doesn't really matter that he only has one Fire Elemental in his hand. It's actually the best card, you know, possible if you only can have one card in your hand. And 6-0 kind of has like a do nothing hand. Okay, so until he drew the Azure Drake, his hand was kind of like a do nothing hand. You know, a whole bunch of like kind of situational cards like Blood Mage and the Heal Bot. The Drake is a really nice draw. It'll give him a lot more, I guess, like reach in his hand, you know, as far as like how many, like when he'll run out of cards. But this, it was really important for Savitz to take out this mech because of the weapon. If the Power Mace went off there, it'd be super hard to make a comeback, so.
Yeah, would have been a big problem for Rogue player. But now, I mean, how do you handle this Fire Elemental? I guess you can't really Drake on the back of this, unfortunately. So you're going to have to sacrifice your Drake, basically.
Just like fight your way through it. You can't kill this turn. Wow, the Lothab draws is really big. Savitas, I think, thinking about counting, you know, lethal turns, is pretty much threatening lethal the next turn here with the Lothab lockout.
Yeah. Jumper, would you go face here if you're Savitas, like, forever? Because, like, what can Sixo really do in this position?
Well, like Strifegro said, the Lothab was such a big play on that turn. And I even like the added 2 damage. So if you count on one of your minions dying, which in this case is not even going to happen without taking significant damage, then you've set up to win. And that Lothab really locked it up.
Yeah, the heal bot, let's see. Does 6-0 survive here? Because he can heal back up to 20 and take out the Flame Tongue Totem. That'll make him, six. I think, just barely survive.
Correct, he will be at 2.
Wow, that's encouraging.
Or rather, no.
more than that, actually.
He'll be at 6, right, actually.
Yeah. Yep.
The Noitron Not too great of a top deck, but it is a mech here.
Yeah, it is going to get buffed if the anti-kill bot goes down, so Savitch is going to actually keep a pretty good board despite the early, fairly awful hand. I mean, it didn't seem too good to get double mech warp with the Rockbiters, but it really transitioned super well with the Zap-O-Matic forcing the prep to be used for the combo purpose.
Yeah, this is very awkward. 6-0 has to Blood Flurry this turn, but his Blood Flurry can realistically do 4 damage here, so the Fire Elemental has to be sapped. But or eviscerated, actually, that seems a little bit better. Because if he saps the Fire Elemental, it just comes right back, does 3 damage. And also, Savitz has no more cards in his hand, right? So if you sap it, you pretty much give him something perfect to do.
Yeah, no, I think the Blade Fury is actually really good here because he's going to wipe the board and still be left on 11 health. And now Savitz has to start top decking stuff like Fellreaver, but then that gets answered. So I think 6-0 is going to be able to comfortably transition into a sprint turn coming up very soon.
Yeah, I mean, yeah,
I was a little surprised that Savitz went face or went to trade with the Lothev back then.
Okay, yeah, the turn where he traded.
A Tinker Royal turn, because I think the only way that Savitz was gonna, I mean that 6-0 was gonna make a comeback was gonna be like the Tinker Royal Blood Flurry there, and leaving up a minion is kind of dangerous against the Tinker Royal turn perhaps, but yeah, he needed that damage as well. So
we're seeing a lot of shamans play it a little bit more controlly. Savitz, without any cards, he's looking for a big one here, like
a Doomhammer, for instance. Yeah, no more Rockbiters left, but that could be just enough. 6-0 is not happy to see this. He's like, oh my god, my days are counted. How do I push for lethal?
Yeah, Doomhammer basically is like a clock here, right? Because the rogues generally don't run any taunts. There might be some healing in the rogue deck, but you know, other than that, they will die to Doomhammer over 2 turns here. So basically means that 6-0 wants the race here. He needs to think of a way where he can potentially threaten lethal before, you know, before he dies. I guess he's just like playing as much power as he can on board and just
right,
trying
I believe
to
this does threaten lethal. So yeah. It's up to Savitz to top deck. 3 Oh, oh. That'll do it.
That's a guaranteed lethal for Savitz with exactly the card that he needed at the very end there. It couldn't have been Lava Burst because Lothab.
Wow.
So that, right? Unless I'm mistaken. I think it had to be this. Oh, it could have been Lava Burst. He was actually on 8 mana. Never mind. So he probably had a few outs left in the deck, but that was a really close one. He's going to take it with Mech Shaman. I guess he's getting better luck than Soundstorm did in those last matches against Temple Storm.
Yeah, grown from 6-0 at the end there. Needed with an empty hand, he needed something big. He got it, and then he needed something small for a little bit of damage, and he got that.
I can't even. I mean, Savitz must be really happy because that's the first game locked with the deck that we've seen, you know, perform very well in the hands of Kibler, for instance. You know, your teammate, but Sandstorm played it just recently, like you know, the previous match, and it didn't do nearly as well. So hopefully, it doesn't turn out to be a weak link for Team Archon. I mean, I wonder what they're going to push in next. What would you push out if you're Team Liquid here?
I don't know. Random.
Yeah, there's too many choices. So both of you would say, like, at this stage, it still doesn't matter, like, what you choose.
I think so.
Okay.
Strifecrow, there's some things you can do.
I think that at every stage it doesn't matter.
There's sometimes, like, voodoo magic where you can possibly look up someone's like tendencies and then try to like mind game them into the better pick. But if you do just randomize it, then it's impossible to mind game.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
It's impossible to actually outperform that in theory.
So, yeah, but and I think in some of these situations, it's way too complicated with 11, like 6 different decks, right? Especially at the start.
Especially since you don't even know what the decks are.
Yeah.
There are so many. Warlock could be 4 different types of Warlock, like we mentioned earlier. The Warrior could be 2 different types. The Hunter could be 3 different types, maybe. The Mage could be 3 different types.
Yeah, I think
Warrior could be face Warrior.
Some people base it on like the potential benching rule, I believe. where, like, you know, someone's going to be benched, potentially they think they might switch him out or maybe even leave him in, you know, to mind game the mind game. I don't know. I mean, anything could happen. So
yeah, we saw it done, but it was, you know, it was coming down to like three decks left in the last series. But like at this stage, as you mentioned, going full random, you can basically Nash it by just going full random from both sides. So you just, you know, make it so both teams have it exactly the same by not being able to make an educated guess. But here, would you push 6-0? Like, Hunter and Rogue, is there a common deck they're weak to that Team Liquid might be happy to push out?
I don't know. I don't think so. It's nice that one were picked up the win, though. Because I know that he's been pretty emotional about it recently, so...
Anyway, suppose it were Face Hunter, and suppose it were, like, Rogue on 6-0. Then Sho would really wanted to mid-range Hunter into that. But that's, as usual, like putting a lot of ifs, because you don't know if Sho's running mid-range Hunter, you don't know if 6-0 is running Face Hunter. But you can look at past performance, and in the past, 6-0 has run, let's see, looks like the mid-range Hunter, or at least Archon brought a mid-range Hunter.
All right. Well, I wouldn't be surprised to see the exact same thing. I wonder, like, they still do play a lot with Death Star. I'm pretty sure. I know Firebat used to play a lot with him. And, you know, Death Star's been playing a lot of mid-range. I think he's more of a slower type of Hunter player, so maybe if they're still talking about stuff like this. It tends to be the more consistent deck anyway to bring to tourneys. Like, we saw Frozen Ice attempted a few times early in the league, and it didn't really pay off too much.
This is an example of either both teams randomed or Liquid wants mind game. So, like, they bring mid-range Hunter because they don't expect 6-0 to queue up Rogue again two times in a row. And mid-range Hunter is, like, the worst matchup. I think its worst matchup, potentially, against Archon is exactly this Rogue.
Yeah, I guess Zoo would be worse by a small margin, but not that much.
I think Zoo is, I think Hunters are pretty good against Zoo. I'm not sure. The face one is much better than mid-range, though, against Zoo, so... Mm-hmm. Not sure if it's still favored, though, for Zoo. But, I don't know, I don't feel like this is a bad matchup either. Oh, wait, this is not Rogue.
Okay, wait, what?
Right now? Because there's armor.
I'm so confused. Number one, it's not a Hunter. Number two, Rogue is not a Rogue.
Oh, okay. So there is
This Warrior's a Rogue Hunter...
Wait,
warrior
what?
Class.
They changed the Hunter.
You know, Strife Crow. This is effigy, okay? Somebody died and it summoned a random hero.
All right, we're good now.
Wow, he transformed from a warrior to a hunter. That's the next level in the middle of the game.
I mean, he's an ogre hybrid, right?
Yeah.
You just have to mate with an ogre and then you're going to turn Garrosh into a Muk Mathal.
So the classic Snake Trap plus Knife Juggler opening, you can pretty much never attack into here as a rogue, right? You have to play it safe, kind of, and just go face.
Yep.
If it's Snake Trap, then it's too bad for you. There's actually an Unleash the Hounds, too, and late game, at some point that might kick in, because the Knife Juggler actually doesn't get contested. It's like, this is like the classic really scary situation, right? Because leaving up the Knife Juggler is so risky, but then also attacking it is so risky. Oh, the backstab.
There you go, draws backstabs, that's big. 6-0 was playing the hope I draw backstab game. Sho was playing the hope he doesn't have it, and like it's a little bit late for 6-0, but it works out well still. Sho has a really good curve with a 1-2-3-4, and then 6-0 has the advantage that he knows that that's Snake Trap now, and Snake Trap is generally weak against Rogue.
Yeah, looking at these hands, though, I feel like, you know, that's kind of what I was thinking about earlier about this matchup. I don't actually feel like this is actually a bad matchup for Hunter, especially if you're running Lothab. It's like, Lothab is so strong against Rogue, and you can just kind of, you know, play kind of like the Face Hunter game as the mid-range, because Rogue isn't, you know, you don't have to, I guess, do too much here as far as, like, control their minions go. You know, they don't play that much, and you can just, like, play too many things for them to actually handle, you know, so.
Yeah, actually, his show has a more of a hybrid approach there with the Wolf Rider.
Yeah.
So he's gonna get a good turn six anyway. I mean, he's curving pretty nicely, despite the fact that it's not a high main, which actually makes it maybe better even because it's not weak to one sap.
Exactly. Right. Exactly.
The fact that it's not a high main is so good. The hybridization of Hunter makes it quite a bit better against Rogue since it's the midpoint of mid range and Phase, and Phase Hunter is really good against Rogue.
Yeah, he's getting dangerously close to damage.
To not attack on the trap. I think he has to set up for Blade Flurry on the Snake Trap turn, so that's what Sixa is doing for next turn. And I like his decision to play Lethal last turn. It's just like guaranteeing so much damage, and also you get to play your 5 drop on turn 5 and play like 2 Oink. 3 drops in turn 6.
Now that's damage.
Do we go for the double oink?
I'd probably just Wolf Ride to make sure that I don't get stuck with a crappy one. I mean, Leok would be 3 damage. It wouldn't even be that bad. And it's hard to remove than the other Huffer. But the Huffer would give you damage. I guess ultimately, like, Misha would be somewhat bad if you're expecting, like, a deadly Poison Blade Flurry.
Yeah, generally you want to play your slower minions first and your faster minions later as the Hunter, so generally, you would want to play double Animal Companion and save the Wolf Riders a charge. But in this particular situation, I think he feels like he's committed too much to the board, and he wants to play around AoE, you know, to get that guaranteed 3 damage into something at least. So it makes sense to really play the Wolf Rider here over the second Animal Companion. Even though 2 of the rolls would be good anyways, though, I guess. Like, 2 of the rolls would have gotten that immediate damage, but the Misha would kind of be a disaster on the AoE turn. It doesn't do anything.
This oil is really big.
Yeah, this oil is game changing. Yeah. Actually,
not only does he have the Blood Mage Thalnos, so he can do 5 to each. He also can prep, and then he can sap one of them if he doesn't want to deal with the Death Rattle of the Shredder.
And I think push he has to attack on a Snake Trap maybe first, or do you think he's going to ignore it? Actually, he's going to ignore Snake Trap, right?
Does he win? We didn't even consider that possibility. I didn't even look at it.
I don't think he actually has lethal.
I don't think so either. I don't see the health count because my...
I can't.
Well, he's doing a really good job of getting close to lethal at least, and sapping this is going to force and unleash the hounds on the Blood Mage Thalnos.
Wow.
That has to feel very awkward.
Yeah, so much damage in that turn.
Argent Protector can be used in a Hunter deck, though. I think that's a first for me.
two life here.
Yeah. Hard to imagine 6-0 not getting what he needs off the top 5 cards of his deck.
Yeah, and he's got, you know, Blood Mage plus the draw plus the sprint. Like, that's a lot of card draw.
There it is.
And it's Eviscerate for the lethal, and actually 6-0 gets exactly, you know, 2 cards could have actually done it, and he picked up both. That's...
Yeah, realistically he might have had one more turn too.
Mm-hmm.
For the sprint. Because Show might not have had lethal the next turn anyway, so...
Yeah, he didn't seem to have it right away, so I think he would have been able to get a sprint and wait one more turn. But that's going to be the first match for Team for the first game for Team Archon. That's the first good game. I am kind of surprised at the rush play. You know, at the end there, we were all discussing, you know, how he's going to Blade Flurry, but he just went full face and got a really good value out of it. That was pretty well done by 6-0.
Yeah, that's one of the problems of Snake Trap. I know, like Farabat was told me this at some point. He was saying, like, you know, Snake Trap isn't like in a tournament where people, you know, it's better on ladder because you only play everyone once, kind of, and no one really knows what you're playing. But in a tournament, it's like Snake Trap is kind of like the most unreliable secret because people, you know, especially in a long tournament where people know your deck lists after a while, the Snake Trap can be easily played around. You know, it's one of the secrets that get a lot worse once you know what it is, basically.
No, I can see that. I mean, it's one of those, like, it's a card that's really good. Once in a while, I remember there was a time where the mid-range Hunter metagame was a bit stale, and then people started putting in Snake Trap. And it was all over the metagame for all of a week, and then people start realizing, well, I mean, now that I know what it is, it doesn't work nearly as well against me, because everybody's playing it. So it's really weak to that specific type of, you know, foreknowledge.
Yep.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting how the ability to see what your to know what traps your opponent has really changes it up, because the traps are so much more powerful when you don't know. You're afraid to attack because it could be freezing. You're afraid to like attack between faces and minions. But when you know it's exactly like two freezing trap or one and one explosive trap or snake trap, it makes your decisions a lot easier.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, Archon takes it back. Now it's even again. See, Shaman against Warlock. I don't know. What do you guys think of this matchup? I guess it depends, right? What the Shaman is and what the Warlock is. I would expect to be the Handlock.
I'd assume it's Mech Shaman for one. Like, that's probably what we're going to be seeing. Unless Zelay decides to bring like a mid-range version, which we've seen less and less of. But I mean, it's been cropping up a little bit left and right. If it is Mech Shaman versus Handlock, I think Mech Shaman has a pretty good chance of getting it.
I think Zoo is maybe more common in this league, actually. I wouldn't be surprised if it was Zoo. But Sveets mostly does play Handlock, I think. It's just Zoo is more common in the league overall. So, okay, so it looks like it is.
He gets a key card in his hand, the Hellfire. And what also depends on this matchup is whether or not the Handlock is running two Hellfire. And I would certainly expect Sveets to keep Hellfire, expecting it to be Mech Shaman, which seems to be running rampant all over the place.
Yeah. I believe like an Owl is kind of a card that you can consider keeping too. I think against midrange Shaman, it's like a 100% keep because it's so good against, you know, the Flame Tongue and Manatee Totems. But Mech Shaman, it's a little bit more iffy. I wouldn't say it's a bad keep even against Mech Shaman though. So two Hellfires. I don't know if that's good. It should be good.
Yeah, I think I would argue that would be even good. It might even look like something like a coin Hellfire and Hellfire play. That's possible.
Yeah, it's kind of funny though, because, you know, Cloud9 and I think the Forsen boys, I don't think Shocky brought Shaman like he did before. I think you guys are the only two teams who didn't bring Shaman this week.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, we didn't bring Shaman. Dark Bomb.
Pretty good draw.
Stops the tempo a lot from the Mech Warper.
Shaman's Earth Shock is pretty sick though.
Yeah.
Mech Shaman's got a good draw with a 1, 2, and a 3.
That's a Fire really Guard powerfully. Yeah. Even the Hellfire doesn't clear everything, which is really nice. And the Fire Guard Destroyer next turn, it also, you know, you can't actually do the classic coin Hellfire into Hellfire here anymore. The Twilight Drake is going to be answered by Earthshock as well. But the good thing for Sveets is that Zlay, you know, is almost out of cards. Has a fast curve and it did kind of get cleared by Hellfire, and there's always a risk as the game goes on for the Shaman where you're going to have to play straight into the Molten Giants. I don't think you're happy to see 7, but you know it'll pay off, I guess.
Yeah, that's true. You're actually really unhappy to see it, but you're happy after this turn.
Yeah, you're happy after. You don't
get if everything works out, you're going to get a great 7 attack minute. If things go wrong, you're going to just be down in the ditch. So it seems like the Owl is going to be, you know, a proxy BGH. I mean, I'm taking off 4 damage off the board. Whoa.
Leroy.
That's unexpected. Did you guys... Is this like a homebrewed Mech Shaman that's actually playing more of a, you know, an aggressive playstyle? I haven't seen much of that kind of Shaman recently.
I believe this is the exact deck list that Firebat... I had the opportunity to talk to Firebat yesterday since we were at the same event, and he's been doing really well with this exact Shaman list on ladder. And I was interested in finding out that he had both the Fire Callers and the Leroy. It's a very big face aggressive deck. Less about the mechs.
Yeah, it's really good against, like, say, like uninteractive decks. I guess like decks that aren't really aiming to fight your minions with other minions. Like, the weakness of these kind of minions are that, like, the weakness of these decks are decks that really try to engage in minion combat. You know, things like, I guess, like, Paladin or midrange, even, like, midrange Shaman, these types of decks. But against, like, spell-slinging decks, I think that's why Shaman has been doing so good in this league, because a lot of the most popular decks that people are playing right now to kind of play around Grim Patron War are, like, spell, you know, that decks that don't really aim to engage in creature combat a lot. And Shaman really excels at fighting against those decks, generally. Yeah,
that's a great point, actually. Like, you're not really getting any... Nobody's really trying to fight your board, so you're getting it, and you're snowballing out of control.
Yeah, like these minions, the shaman minions are just like do a lot of damage and they're very powerful, but they're not exactly very sticky. And you know, if you fight things like Zoo, like you know, that deck that fights a lot in minion combat or paladin, then you'll see like the weakness of this deck. So you really want to dodge those matchups because you know, something like a Nerubian Egg plus Power Roaming is gonna crush your board. Also, just like a Shield Minion Bind to Muster for Battle, for example. Wow, just all face here. What is that? How much damage is that?
Yeah, some amount of thinking by Zalay before deciding to put him down to two. I think that's a pretty, I think that's a straightforward decision since it's two.
With Urshel.
Harder because he has absolutely nothing to follow it up. So, but I think that was the best play given the circumstances.
Yeah, this turn, there's no way for Zalay to play around Molten Giants anymore, right? Because to play around it, he would have to like not attack at all. And if he's going to attack, I felt like he might as well just play the Leroy there, so. Two taunts with this, here.
Yeah, that is going to save him because he can't get past both. You can Earth Shock the nine, but you don't have six damage for the either one of these.
I think you trade here, right?
Maybe. Absolutely. Or, absolutely.
I think I would. There's not too much of a point in not, but you can theoretically maximize your thinking here and maybe talk yourself in the face in here. But I don't know. It seems like, from a glance, probably play a little bit safer. You have Draxus if you survive till turn 9. That's quite a bit away, though.
Well, there's 16 damage on the Warlock board at the moment. And, I mean, there's really nothing that Zalay can do to counter it, besides playing his own minions and threatening for more damage. So there's a chance that unless a Crackle is picked up or a Lava Burst...
Yeah. That, I actually don't think this game will go to turn 9. Someone's going to die before then. I feel Zalay only has maybe one or two more turns before he dies, and so there's no way Sweet is going to need the Drax. It's either going to be someone top decking some damage or someone top decking a heal block to end the game.
Exactly.
Those are the most important draws right now.
What's Sweet's
probably
bar can
not
be good.
Expecting to lose, but he's going to be really happy to see this.
Yeah.
Have well, one turn,
Mortal Coil, that's nice. He needs to find a way to cycle this, I feel. Right, because this is a way for him to lock out the game by drawing a heal bot.
If he draws a heal bot, this game is lost. Oh! And he picks it up. This is just not believable. I don't. Okay, so Zalay could still get back to back lava burst, right?
I don't think he'll survive that long, though. He won't have two turns, right?
Like unless the next turn he's dying. Trades are made.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, trades are made.
Maybe he's still going to die next turn, though. Probably not, actually.
Like, next turn Lava Burst and following turn Lava Burst could lead to you winning right away. Well, that's not it.
I don't know. Technically, I think it might have been a mistake for Sweets. I feel like if he kept his Lothab up, he would have thrown lethal this turn already. You know, so, and with two taunts, like gigantic taunts there, I don't think it was necessary to make the trade on the Chillin' Yeti.
Yeah, the Savit maybe think that because it's his homebrew, there's a chance that there's a lightning storm, so his Lothab just dies to AoE. I'm just trying to figure out like what the reasoning was. There's probably a good reason for it.
I think
we just have to ask him directly.
Maybe something like double or shock, right? If you leave up two minions, you're closer to playing. Or something like Flametongue Totem plus one or shock. Maybe they can, you know, leave up enough things where they could actually still get through. So,
yeah, I think. It may have been just the classic Hemlock trap of you see you're so far ahead that you just want to play safe. But by playing safe, sometimes you risk your opponent drawing into an out.
Yeah, sometimes you just gotta race, go ham on it. Well, but you know, we see this game, Sleece pretty much has it locked out after the heal bot top deck. More taunts.
Yeah, that's a pretty comfortable card to have, unless you want to go for the Hellfire, but then you're risking, like, the only way you lose is if your opponent plays a Crackle, high roll, a spell damage totem.
There's no way that Sweet's got Hellfire. He was counting the way he does it. Hellfire, I think, but he doesn't have lethal first. He's too off with the Hellfire. I expect just like a Fire Drake plus Sun Fury and maybe making some small trades, but mostly face.
I concur. This is the point of the game. We're just thinking, like, what's the craziest thing that could possibly happen to be on 9 mana?
There's a lot on the line in this league. So if people are, even in these small situations or these very small spots, you still want to just maximize any potential you have of losing, I guess, just to, you know, make it the best possible chances. But realistically, you know, you can't really lose from here, so...
Yeah, it's just like there's no card that's going to single-handedly go through three taunts and then deal 10 damage to you at once. Like, that's just not happening.
I don't think so.
Deathwing could have been an upset. Oh man, Deathwing. Deathwing's always an upset, but it just doesn't make sense. Right, okay, never mind that then. Oh man. Alright, so turns out gonna get a second win here. So Savitz is well on his way.
Well, Savitz is done. All right.
Yep.
Wow.
2-0 for the day, Savitz. You can go rest easy or maybe scout for the team, I guess. At this point, you're kind of gathering information, staying, maybe helping other teammates.
Yeah.
But what do you do when you're done, by the way? Like, what is it you do when you're done playing? What's stick around?
I don't know. I've been playing super bad at Archon. Okay. I think that's the biggest reason why my team isn't doing that great. Last week I won, I was like, oh man, I'm done, finally. I was just like a sigh of relief. Then I watched the rest of the series, but I was in a much better mood after.
I have the utmost trust in my team, so I went to get a haircut last week.
Oh, okay. Sounds good.
Wait, what? I'm so lost right now.
Last week, I got an early 2-0, so I was like, okay, good job, team. You guys got it from here.
Okay, and you were right, I guess, because Kibler's been doing fantastic. I mean, he's the only undefeated player as of yet in the league. I think in week 2, there were still like 3 to 4 players who were really doing well, but Kibler's 8-0 right now in the league, so you've got all the reasons in the world to trust in him.
Very nice when you have a 100% player on the team. The rest of the team just go 50-50. Easy game.
Really, what you're saying right now is he could carry. The thing is, at some point, all the other players have to win anyway. Like, so it doesn't...
That's true, but it takes so much pressure off. You can just go 50-50 and you're good.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what Team Liquid decides to push. Now, Savitz being away means that there's no way his lineup can be targeted. But Sho and Neria, when it comes to two players, like the benching rule almost scares me more. Because if you push one player twice and they lose, then the other one absolutely has to win with one of his decks. And it can be targeted, you know, multiple ways to where maybe a team gets an advantage of like four wins over two, perhaps.
Theoretically, it's harder to win as you... Like your final games, right? Like because people can counter you and they have more options. You know, probably. I guess it depends if you've won. Like it depends which decks you've won with. Because if you like saved your strongest decks for last, then maybe it won't be hard. But maybe some people say if you win with your strongest class. I know it's happened a lot in this league where like your final wins are the hardest because you've like have some weak classes in the last game and. You've seen like gigantic comebacks from like a 2-5 or even like maybe like a 3-5 into like, you know, a lose from there. So
yeah, well, we had a pretty big upset earlier today, you know, 1-4 and then 6-4 in the favor of the team was a 1-win. So that then again, like the early stages, as you mentioned earlier, might matter a lot less than the initial expectations are. It really comes down to the last 3 decks very often.
Yeah, I think looking at it against Team Liquid, like looking at it from Team Liquid's perspective, it's really about, I think the Druid is the weakest class left, and it's really about picking up that win on the Druid here on Nerea, because the other decks like Warrior Hunter and Mage even should be able to pick up a win relatively easy at some point. We've seen like Druid just like actually tank entire series before too, so it's like it's riding a lot on the early openings, like as far as drawing your Wild Growth and Innervate sometimes, and also Druid does have kind of a lot of unfavorable matchups as well, which is probably not one of the stronger classes in the grand scheme of things. So,
that's a good point. I think the only matchup that Druid is favored against on Archon side is the Mage, if it is Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it's actually bad against the other mages. But Firebat probably is fun Freeze Mage. He's like a kind of even like a, you know, like a one of the best Freeze Mage players. So.
Yeah, and
it's also pretty good against Handlock, but last week Archon brought Zoo.
Mm-hmm. I expect Firebat to be Zoo. He's a Zoo monster.
I was gonna say not only does he draw everything he needs, but on top of that, he also plays very well.
So that sounds nice. Warrior against Warlock. I think Patron against Zoo.
I think so too, which will be a relief for Team Liquid. It's a good matchup. It's but not good as matchup. Good as some might think it is.
It's not as good, but it's one of the best. It's one of the best matchups you can have against Zoo. Because Zoo is not actually that weak against, you know, most things, I guess. It's pretty much like Face Hunter is maybe worse and... what? Maybe Freeze Mage? I don't know.
Freeze Mage, perhaps, yeah.
Paladin, I guess. I'm not sure, but it's still one of the worst matchups you can have, especially the version that Sho plays. It's very anti-Zoo in a way, I guess, because he actually is very much based around combo, and he's like cut his curve very low. I don't think Sho runs Scrom a lot. I think he's like very combo based. Like he usually runs double and stable ghoul and things like that. Those are really good cards against Zoo.
I think one of the weaknesses that Sho's version has against Zoo is he only runs one Fiery War Axe, but he drew the Fiery War Axe against Zoo, which is the best card you could get here, so.
Yeah. There's been a lot of discussion about that, you know, the double Fiery War Axe versus a single one, just to give yourself a bit more flexibility. The thing is, those aggressive decks, you feel like the Whirlwinds and the AoEs and the Slams can handle them pretty nicely. But then sometimes you don't get the axe or any weapon at all. Then the mid game starts looking very shaky.
I gotta say, out of all the cards that could have been cut out of Patron, Fiery War Axe was one of the least like ones that I expected. I always thought it was the best card in the game.
I know, right?
I kind of like the cut in these versions, though. I kind of understand why. Like these are. I guess you can't afford to take as much damage on a Patron War as control War. You have much less source of armor, and these decks, like especially if you're adding in like a smaller mana curve with double unstable ghoul and you know a lot of the things like Inner Rage, it maybe makes sense to cut it. I think the versions with Grom more tempo based. I feel like Grom turns her deck into more of a tempo-based patron, and like this version is more combo-based, so...
That's a different approach to the deck. I really like the play there from Firebat, from Sho with the Unstable Ghoul, like has the two imps. Even if Definitive Argus comes out, there's no problem there. Yeah, now the two armor smiths...
really weird, because... Yeah. Of the double armor smiths throwing so much armor. There's also this Nalganis Void Terror combination, though, on the other side, so...
And there's also a Sea Giant with no Execute, so it's interesting. Like, those Armorsmiths get really good value. They're going to get at least 10 armor, like, collectively, and that enabled the Battle Rage to draw so many cards.
Yeah, I think Sho needs to start getting some Gigantic turns off, because... Firebat's next couple turns, maybe even this turn, is gonna be insane. I kind of expect to see Mal'Ganis come down here almost like with the Void Terror.
Yeah, I don't think it's a Savitz type of warrior with that runs the brawl. So yeah, I mean makes a lot of sense. It's so unlikely that you get punished for getting that quote unquote all in play.
Yeah, you want to make basically always all in the Patron War as a Zoo. Just like you pretty much just want to. Pressure them as hard as possible, because you know if you don't put enough pressure on, you're gonna get comboed down, and they generally don't have any like AoE kind of clear as far as like clearing out gigantic minions goes. You know they have to execute them or you know somehow deal 8 damage to an 8/8. So I just think he's gonna just storm the board here.
Yep. The only safe grace for Sho is that he opened with so much armor, but this is a heavy board to be up against.
Yeah, no execute yet, and he doesn't have like he's got one card in like one card with the Gnomish Inventor, but it's still not quite there. Oh man, that's got to feel very threatening if you're Sho. You're like, where are my executes?
Yeah. I feel like it's kind of weird. This is gonna be a hard turn, but I feel like Sho wants to set Deathbite for the Whirlwind effect as soon as possible, because he also has the Grim Patron and Inner Rage.
Right,
looks like he's just going for it.
Yeah, and how Zoo removed that, Rhea? You're right, like, this is a pretty good option, because he's going to get not only a ton of armor to compensate for the fact that he's getting punched in the face repeatedly for about 20 a turn, but he's also going to be able to counter with some of his own aggression and force Firebat in a weird position once the board gets cleaned up.
Yeah, wow, both decks are really shining here. Like,
yeah, both of these decks are doing what they're meant to do, like, as well as possible. You know what I mean? Like, sometimes, like, decks don't do what they're meant to do, like, with bad draws, but both of these pairs are, like, drawing perfectly, almost, it seems, and, like, you can really see the power of both decks here.
Yeah, it's like, wow, I can attack for 27 as Zoo on turn 7, but that's no good.
It's not enough.
Yeah, when are you ever going to see that happen? Oh man. Didn't think that would happen today, at least.
Crazy. It's like the exact comment I was going to make. I don't know. Yeah, she seems hard for a show, or for a fire bat, even though he has 27 power on board.
Does he have 27 on board?
Yeah.
I can't. Okay. I must be off mathematically. No, oh, man. The patrons are getting cleaned up.
25. He actually traded. I guess you have. Like, patrons are so scary that you have to trade there.
Wow. Nice job, Juggle. Well, Firebat's getting maybe the upper hand here. Wait, is that Frauding Berserker ever a problem? Would that execute? I don't think it is at the moment. You still need to get rid of at least Mal'Ganis. 49 health for show, though. 49. I don't even know what to say.
It means that he has some time for his, like, to build up death spikes, you know, without immediately feeling like he's gonna die. Because normally if you do a death spike move here and not remove this board, you're just gonna die. He has so much extra health, though, that he can kind of play greedy now and try to, I guess, like, get value from his health, because he needs to buy some time for him to set up more combo potential. So this is his turn that he used.
Yeah, and it's looking pretty good for show right now.
What an insane game. I was actually about to say it was looking really good for Firebat.
Really? Okay.
It's like, I'm not sure.
So it's good for both, basically.
It depends if you have to attack into the Mal'Ganis, huh? Because that's 9 damage again. Like, if you have to attack into Mal'Ganis with that death spite, or if he picks up a way, like, some other way, because...
There was a lot of patience.
Firebat's really healthy too at 28. This Mal'Ganis is, like, making all snaps free. So it's hard for him to threaten lethal immediately with a Strahling Berserker, too.
Yeah, a lot of patience by show also, because he could have used Whirlwind there with the one extra mana to deny 8 damage from the Void Tear. But this is a really unusual game where he's managed to gain, I don't know how much armor, but I'm going to estimate it to be about 20 to 30.
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, Firebat used 30 damage of overkill on patrons. Like, pretty much. Like, 25 damage on 3 patrons, and then an extra knife on the last one. Because, you know, why not?
Yeah, I wonder if Firebat's actually thinking of imposing his own guy, because, you know, he thought about this turn a lot.
He wants to get rid of it. Makes sense, since it's just gonna die to a whirlwind effect anyway. That's pretty good.
It's interesting.
Yeah, that is interesting. Because normally I think that play really makes sense if you think you're not going to have anything on board, you know, the next turn. I guess it makes sense, because if you want a power rolling next turn...
I wonder if you could be thinking so far ahead to, like, yes, you can use the power overwhelming anytime, but you're going to get to 9 mana next turn, so if you draw Doomguard, then you can play the 4 and the 5.
Mm-hmm. I actually like it, because in this matchup, at this point especially, you're very unlikely to make the trade here, right? Like, power rolling trade and minion. It's more like power rolling face damage at this point.
Yeah, you get to keep it a little bit for flexibility in case you have another Void Terror or you have a Nerubian Egg, but ultimately it is going to face.
Yeah.
The Notion Venture is going to give him some flexibility here to actually trade into Mal'Ganis without face tanking if he wants to. He's going to opt to take the damage to the face. Okay. I guess that's good. Whoa, he still plays a Gnomish?
He's trying to keep his Gnomish alive.
So he wants to keep the Gnomish Inventor alive. That's not what I expected. Okay. Well, that's pretty... It's a board-heavy play.
Well, after that really exciting early game, looks like things have settled down a bit. With the result being, Sho has managed to get through his about 50 to 70 health pull.
It took a long time, though, if you think about it. Like, the board from Firebat was absolutely insane. The kind of board that you look at and you just concede, but Sho's actually still in there.
Yeah, here we just need a Grim Patron and then we win.
Now it's I don't know, the final scratches. Whirlwind, though. Best bite.
Whirlwind's nice. It doesn't even spawn a imp. Or rather, if you.
This is actually a full board clear if you use your. No, not full, I think. You can't clear the 2/2 imp gang, right?
No, I think you don't clear the 3/4. Well, actually, no, you can
choose. You would clear the 3/4, wouldn't you? Like, you could clear everything.
You have your choice on which one to clear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's not that easy to decide.
Yeah. Because technically, it doesn't actually matter that much at this point, even if the other person top decks a demon, because Zoo doesn't have anything to do with mana anyways, you know, so it doesn't, like, say you get a Doom Guard or whatever, it doesn't even matter that it's free or not from the Void Terror.
Yeah, because it would play it anyway for 5.
Yeah, it could just play it for 5 with 10 mana.
Thinking it through, does it in the right order. He's decided to go with this play. The Prowling Berserker doesn't have anything that can be dealt with, that can deal with it, and he's killing the Void Terror. Void Caller, rather.
Doomguard is lethal.
Yeah, life tap into Doomguard would cut it, so...
There's actually a very high chance at Doomguard.
Well, no, it's still good. And no armor smiths left, right, in the warrior deck. So this is going to be either find shield block very soon, or pick up a patron, I guess. That would also solve your problems a little bit.
A lot of card draw coming.
That trade is so good.
You can't risk that, can you?
I don't know, it's not actually obvious to me. Oh! No, yeah, I think that's right, honestly. That's actually the right decision, but it's a super hard decision to make.
Wait, you need that damage,
and there's actually no reason, not that much reason to kill it.
If you draw Execute and you go Warsong Commander, Frothing Berserker...
I think you could get it, right?
And Acolyte, you would win. Or, no, you don't go Acolyte, you just Battle Rage, try to draw 4 cards, and then you try to get
an Execute. Yeah, you want to set up for your biggest Battle Rage.
It's not even an Execute, like, any 1 damage will work.
Well, I mean, you can use the Acolyte to draw twice. With this
Wait, I think that's a mistake.
Is it?
This might be lethal.
Oh, no, never mind. Yeah, I guess that's lethal.
Oh, yeah, because you can remove.
I was thinking, okay, you need to draw an answer with Battle Rage, but the Acolyte of it was an answer.
The Whirlwind with double Frothing Berserker is just too much damage. I think this is actually like way more than 30, probably.
What an exciting game.
It's not that much.
Well, that's gonna be it. The Frothings again. I don't even know why it's called Patron Warrior when it's basically Frothing Warrior.
I guess he should have traded.
Yeah, I guess. You're right, Strifeco. A little bit of a very all-in play from Firebat, not trading into that Frothing Berserker. I think he would have had a really good chance of winning, right?
You have to feel kind of all-in at that point.
Oh, man. Firebat. So, turns out Team Liquid is going to grab their third win with the Patron of Water locked for Sho, so he still has another deck to go with, and Neria has his 2 decks up. So, maybe they'll be down to, like, 1 player left. If Sho's queued up again with his Hunter, that's going to maybe all come down to Neria's Mage and Druid.
Oh my gosh, that was the craziest Patron Zoo matchup I've ever seen.
Yeah. It's usually a snowball either way, but not this time.
They basically both had almost like the perfect kind of opening, so.
Yeah,
well, Team Celestial's sad right now. They really want Liquid to lose.
Well, I mean, Druid, again, you mentioned was the weak link because if Firebat's playing a Freeze Mage, then that's the only deck that really wins. But if Firebat brought Tempo, which I would find very weird because I it's not a deck that I frequently associate Firebat also, with.
Yeah, Druid against Hunter should be, I guess, good for Druid, depending. Actually, yeah, it should be decent against all kinds of Hunters. I think Druid is better against Face Hunter than Midrange Hunter, and Sixo is more known to play Face Hunter. But even Druid against Midrange Hunter isn't that bad either way, so.
Yeah. Well, it's still going to be a tough... Like, it's funny because they did bring 2 quote-unquote underdog classes by not including Rogue in their lineup. I mean, Savi's won right away with Shaman, but he still got a Druid in the lineup.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what they bring.
The thing about Rogue being a quote-unquote underdog, or being not an underdog class, is a little unusual, because the reason why Rogue is so good is because it's strong against the top, I'd say, three decks. Mm-hmm. But it turns out that it's not great against, like, things that aren't the top three decks. So it turns out that because you bring underdog classes, the Rogue deck is actually a lot less good.
Yeah. That's actually, I think, another class that's kind of similar to that Rogue style, where it's good against just the best classes, I think, is maybe something like Control War. Like, I think Control War is right now is, like, really good against just, like, the very best three classes, you know, like, maybe, like, Patron Warrior, you know, like, Face Hunter or something. It's, like, it's like kind of, like, good. It's, like, kind of, like, has that Rogue dynamic going, but against, like, a lot of, like, the mid-range decks, Control War isn't so good, but those decks aren't very popular right now, so...
Well, we'll see. It's going to be Druid versus Hunter. Like you mentioned, it wasn't that bad of a matchup, so it turns out Neria might be able to lock it with the Druid. There's a chance.
Right. It's almost like the game for our Team Liquid, the game plan is like, okay, we got to find a place to get our weakest deck through, the Druid. That's our greatest chance of going like 1-5, or I mean 0-5. They've managed to pick out a pretty good spot against it. It's not the best case, but I'd say it's the second best case.
Yeah.
We didn't see Xyxos Hunter, did we? Or is that was that a deck with Snake Trap?
I don't think we've seen it. I think we've seen Xyxos Hunter, but not Xyxos Hunter.
Right. That was Xyxos Hunter with a Snake Trap. That didn't quite work out.
Yeah.
Yep. Oh. Last week, Archon brought a very standard mid-range Hunter, so we'll see if that happens again. If it's mid-range Hunter, I do actually... I'm a little more... pessimistic about the Druid's chances in Strafcrow. I think it's a good matchup.
I think it's good for mid-range Hunter. It's just not that bad, but Face Hunter should be Druid favorite, so...
I agree with that.
He has to hope that it's Face Hunter. Just the freezing traps are really powerful against Druid. Also, High Main is obviously very hard to deal with, so... Actually, a scary card that's actually maybe you don't think about too much in this matchup is actually Houndmaster, because Druid's like doesn't really have a lot of ways to come back from a strong tempo turn with Houndmaster, unless you have the Keeper. But even then, like it's not because like you're dropping a 2/4 into the 4/3. So
Lyra with a very reasonable hand here. Of course, the Wild Growth, something you always want to see. No turn. No obvious like follow-up to it is the only weak point.
Yeah, if there's a Mad Scientist here, that's a pretty decent start. Oh wow, alright, there it is.
There's a Harrison Jones soul, it's not exactly a 5-drop after Wild Growth, though. It's actually a pretty good pickup, Lazenarita curve out. Lazenarita curve out pretty good here.
So if you pick up a Shredder, what do you do?
He would play the Shredder, but oh man, that Face Hunter. That's a good curve, and Nairia probably wanted this matchup, but he's going to want some defensive cards real quick.
Yeah. 6-0 plays around Keeper and Swipe with this move here, because he had the potential Knife Juggler on this turn, and also potential the double 1-drops, but again, they'd be weak to Keeper and Swipe respectively. You really want to play around their mana curve if you can, because it's better to play something like a Juggler on turn 5, for example, to get Keeper there than on turn 4.
Yeah, especially since the Growth is still the best, like one of the rare cards in Druid that really lets them handle aggro, especially when it's ramped out. Like it really gives them a much better chance in the entire rest of the game when they get it off.
Yeah, if you get turn 5 swiped or Keepered, it you know a lot of times they're missing their 4 drop because Druids have a lot of 5 drops, so they usually can hit a 5 drop anyways.
Okay, this is not looking too bad. I mean, the Ancient of Lore can always heal you if you really need the healing.
Reaper is actually kind of decent as well, just because it's kind of hard to ignore. I mean, probably it is going to get ignored, but it gets a lot of value leaving it up.
Definitely expect Ariel looks ahead, given his hand as well, and decides that he needs to take care of that too. I think it's the right call. Without that, it would deal... the Hunter would deal just a bit too much damage.
What trap is that, do we know? Because it might change his play, maybe.
Yeah. If it's not freezing, you have to... Trap. Oh, swipe. All right. So he was playing around swipe. Letting his opponent get it wouldn't be an option for him. Oh.
Is that guy threatening enough to kill in your face, Hunter?
I don't think so. You can't kill this, right? No way.
And do you even play around swipe at this point, or are you just all in? I think you're all in.
Yeah, the problem here is that if you don't kill it, you're all in against swipe. But if you do kill it, I just feel like you don't win the game. And you know, don't you feel like there might be a read here, right? Because it's hard to make the call to play Emperor over swipe. Even if you did have swipe against face hunter, you're taking too much damage.
Well, you
so
probably would, yeah. Probably well, most of the time, you would have seen swipe if it was there, I guess.
No swipe draw, pretty bad.
I wonder if given that though, maybe you should have. Oh, never mind, because you have the snakes out, so you don't want to play Leopard Worgen.
Oh, not a good trap to see here. Take out four from the board.
Actually,
you put in
Leopard Worgen makes a lot of sense too. I guess it's just too many cards. I mean, too many. Not enough room for snake trap then.
Right. You would only get
one. You want to pair slow cards first and your fast cards later, so keeping your chargers for the last drop, the last card damage.
Oh, that is it. That would be exactly lethal.
That's unfortunate. Liquid managed to match up against one of the best classes Druid could have gone against.
It's just doubly unfortunate too, because now you're never gonna get your Druid against this face hunter anymore. You know, it's not like your Druid doesn't win here. It's the fact that from here on, your Druid looks even worse against the rest of the lineup than before. So,
well, I mean, it's a little bit of good news that it was even face hunter, because it easily could have been mid range hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're
now,
right.
Here's where the mind games begin, because do you queue up Druid again because you expect, okay, they just played their Druid, so we're going to bring in Freeze Mage, and then that'll probably dodge the Druid because they're afraid of getting benched. Or do you sit out the Druid one more time because you would get benched and then they could just play their Freeze Mage and win otherwise?
Yeah, this is when the picks become really interesting. Because there's like a huge mind game potential at this point. Like at the start of the series, it's kind of not that interesting. It's really hard to say, but it comes down a lot to this.
Yeah, there's like one matchup left in area to really pick up, and that's Firebat queuing with the Freeze Mage. But the thing is, if you queue anything else into the Freeze Mage and it wins, then Naria is pretty much out of good matchups at this point. Like, he already lost one. It wasn't that good of a matchup in the first place, but it's just that will it come down to another Savitz-like situation where you're stuck with Druid and you just end up taking too many losses in a row to it, like with it? Yeah. Like that was
actually
a really unfortunate.
Savitz is not
week.
The Druid player. This like they switched out their Druid.
Yeah, it's not.
Maybe it's putting
it's
too much
anymore.
Pressure on Savitz, for example, to play Druid in this kind of format.
Well, it was other, one like, week it went wrong, but the other 2 weeks it went well.
One of the other things that I found a little bit interesting is that Firebat's the one playing that Shaman to like High Legend, so I'm surprised that 6-0 got to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's because Firebat is just so renowned as being good at Freeze Mage and Zoo.
Zoo, yeah.
I mean, wasn't Zele playing that one?
I mean, so many of the top players in these teams can play so many decks well, so it's even hard to say who should get what, you know, like,
yeah,
a lot of them
it's obvious. It's like
good,
the edges are really small, right? Like, at this point, the people who've mastered deck, I guess, like, Kibler is very open about the fact, for instance, that he doesn't know anything about Rogue and he mm-hmm. doesn't know anything about Freeze Mage. From a playing perspective, I mean, he understands the matchups well, but he doesn't play it nearly enough. He says to pilot it so confidently. But when you look at all the players that we have here, let's say between Team Liquid and Archon, those are all players that we've seen play a variety of decks, and they feel very comfortable, like, with all of them. So it's really hard to decide who to assign it to.
Yeah, it's actually good to be a specialist in this league if you actually get a benefit from, say, only playing, you know, one deck really good, if you have the choice of doing that.
Well, last hero standing time, really emphasized that, so go ahead.
At the same time, it's a slight disadvantage, because if you're, like, you can assume Firebat's playing Freeze Mage and Zeo by default, so...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. You can almost predict what was going to be coming up. Well, we're going to be getting to Neria versus Zelay. Let's see if Zelay brings anything but Patron.
Actually, the disaster, because you don't want Druid against Patron. And furthermore, if you lose, then they can play Freeze Mage.
Yeah, and then your Druid has no chance of getting it.
Once they play Freeze Mage, and if that Freeze Mage picks up a win, then you're never going to get that matchup for Druid. So that's big.
So this game is really important for Team Liquid to win. Like, they're up 3-2, and like that should make them pretty comfortable. But if they lose this one, the chance that it swings around to Archon is really high. Like, even though Archon just ties it up 3-3, that Druid is a very big liability.
Yep. Not a great hand for Patron Warrior. I think, like, the Dream Hand is something like Deathbite, Grim Patron, and Inner Rage at some point. You know, you probably don't want the exact hand. I mean, it'd actually be perfect to have the exact hand because it's so good. But, you know, that's ultimately what you're going for on, like, turn 5. It's, like, almost a free win against Druid because they can't really clear Patrons. Oh, actually, he picks up two of those. For some reason, I was talking, I guess he didn't mulligan yet when I saw that hand.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's one of those things where I don't think the Druid is that bad off. Like, it's not as bad as playing Face Hunter into Patron. It's more like a 40-60, maybe, I think. Like, it's a bad matchup, but it's not a disastrous one. It's a disaster if he loses here, because the entirety of the rest of the matches or the games will be dictated by that Freeze Mage winning.
Also, I agree with you there.
Pretty good.
Furthermore, I don't even think it's as bad as 40-60. Like, I think it might be 45.
Oh, wow. Yeah, sure. I mean, that seems to be in line with my experience of watching them play. Like, I haven't played nearly as much Druid against Patron to notice it, but when I see the matches, it doesn't come down to, like, it's not a blowout for the Warrior player.
I think what makes Patron so good is that it doesn't have ridiculously good matchups against certain decks. It's just, overall, against the field, it's got, like, slightly increased odds of winning every single one. So maybe against the majority of decks, it's like 55-60% to win just by default.
Yeah, but the double shade here in Neria's hand is quite good because you can just coin out one, then play the second, and then start coining out, start playing the Pilot of Shredders. Like, he doesn't need Wild Growth at the moment.
Yeah, that shade was really good. I think Zlay was thinking, he tanked this whole turn one. I think he wanted more time to think about this because you can play Patron Warrior with a high tempo style as well. I do prefer the tempo style against Druid. So he played, for example, the Ghoul on turn two. He's going to play Frothing on turn three after the Ghoul on turn two. Like, that's, you know, why you would play the Ghoul on turn two. And it makes a lot of sense to play like this against Druid. You just, like, once you get ahead on Druid, that's, like, always been the weakness of Druid. So,
yeah, it'll be really big if he draws Deathbite right now. But even if he doesn't, he does have the turn 6. It's going to be definitely Patron, Inner Rage, Whirlwind.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And he actually has kind of like some board presence as well already, so.
The Deathbite would have been huge because then it would allow for it to go around Goff one turn five. Earlier. Yeah.
That would have been way devastating.
You might be able to go off on turn 5 if your ghoul survives, then you can just suicide your ghoul for the whirlwind effect.
Oh, that's right.
Well, I mean, is Neria ever going to just deal with this?
I think Neria is probably going to self next turn, though.
Yeah, he kind of has to, otherwise there's a risk of disaster. Yeah.
The choice here, I guess, is whether or not to hit the face with the axe, and I like it. Doesn't seem very useful against most of the Druid's minions. No, he chose not to.
This is pretty good. This is a pretty good time to unstealth. I mean, your board's already, sort of okay. You know these shades, like the second one's probably not going to be that relevant, and you're still putting a shredder on the back of it. So you're not completely... much better. Wow, what a play. How did we not see that? What, did you see that, Strife Pro, or were we just all blind to this BGH? And
I guess blind to the BGH.
Okay, that sounds about right. Oh. That's a bit of a different turn. you can still get a pretty good play. I mean, Axe plus Execute will handle them, and then you can play... What? Oh man, it's just so slow, though, compared to what you really want to do.
It has to look good. It has to be an Axe and Execute turn. If you use your Patron this turn, if you Patron this turn, you're very likely not going to have enough to snowball from there. Okay. And, you know, because, the other person's board kind of just deals with the Patrons this turn, so...
Sometimes I wonder if Zalay saw ahead so far as to not hitting the face last turn. Like, okay, so my guy can get BGH'd, and I'm going to execute, so I'm going to actually save the Axe so I can hit these two minions.
I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, it seems to make sense that if BGH is going to be smaller. That,
right? Because even if you did get BGH'd and the Shredder came down, you would still want both charges. For example.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if the shard didn't come down, just to hit the shade and still have a charge left.
So bad news for Zalay here. Even though he does have the combo, Drizzt's going to be able to deal with it just off of this board. Well, and the Force of Nature.
Force of Nature will actually deal with the three little ones in the 4-3, the big one, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Actually, there's going to be two big ones, isn't there?
Do you ever Emperor and attack into the 4-2? And
you can think about Emperor here for sure, but I'm not sure.
Because then if the opponent deals with it, he has to use a hero power, which forces him to have a 4-drop on the back of it. So he can't play, for instance, in this case, his own Emperor. But he might curve into Dr. Boom and then welcome to hell.
Tempo is important in this matchup. I actually kind of don't like Emperor as much, because once you get too low, Druids can just threaten combo.
Like now?
Yeah.
Like, you know, next turn. Typical turn. That's actually enough to play all the Patrons and all the Whirlwinds and all the Inner Rages.
Yeah, that War Song is a huge pickup. It actually kind of makes his play, you know, reasonable now.
Yeah.
A lot of it depends what comes out of this Shredder, because if anything, you know, a lot of what can come out is a liability against Grim Patrons if it has less than 3 attack, and most of the time it will have less than 3 attack, I think, so
yeah,
we'll see.
Unstable Ghoul, no!
Oh,
that's unfortunate.
But he's not dead to combo. The thing is, he's almost dead, like, because Dr. Boom is bound to come out.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, would you play... I guess you could play Keeper on that War Song, but what else afterwards? It seems so weak.
Yeah, the Druid has to play whatever costs the most mana, pretty much. And that's going to be Dr. Boom instead of the kill next turn.
Right? Do you think he's thinking about trading an Emperor here and saving 2 Patrons? Because he was thinking quite a bit here, and it makes some sense. You're only getting 1 card value from Emperor, and it might be stronger to have 2 Patrons here just because 1 Patron could be killed easily.
Yeah.
Whereas 2, maybe it's a little bit harder, but...
Okay, so this is combo to clear the board, right? There's no way it's for anything else. You're denying Battle Rage comebacks in every single way here.
Patron Wars plays so poorly from top deck mode, right? Because it's a combo deck. And with 1 card in hand, you feel like you could easily win this game as a Druid just by clearing and playing the control game.
Yeah, he's not going to be too wrong about that. I mean, Deathbite gets picked up, but the Harrison Jones is good.
Yeah. Might not even swing, though. Might not equip Deathbite, I'm not sure.
I like that. It's going to get punished, though.
Yeah. Pretty heavily, in fact. It's a sad day for all the warriors around the world. Although he did win against Amalganis, who stayed on the board for 17 turns just recently, so...
The Wrath is a good pickup perfectly, too, here. You can Wrath to remove it now.
You know, how many, weapons has Harrison Jones killed overall? Like, in the game? Because I keep wondering, has the Ooze or Harrison Jones killed more weapons based on the entire game? Because you would expect the Ooze to do it. But so many more people play Harrison than the Ooze that I'm starting to wonder. Like in Legend, Which of those has the most kills?
Legend, Harrison Jones. Name? And overall, Hearthstone, Ooze has killed more. That's my estimate by far.
I'd have to ask Blizzard. I'm really curious.
Yeah.
I want stats, Blizzard. Release them now.
Inner Rage. Not too important, but it deals with the minion. Just, it's not, it's, that's, patrons just can't play from this position, you know? I don't even know what you would top deck, because even like something Battle Rage doesn't actually get value from a top deck mode perspective. You actually need to set up the Battle Rage. It's like a, it's a card that takes a lot of setup, right? So in this kind of situation, I don't even know what he's going for when you have one card. Like, what can you risk a draw? That's why like the Grom version is more tempo based, because like Grom is like an individually powerful card. This is a very combo list, so can't really draw anything.
Yeah, there have been comebacks, but you know, as you said, they kind of rely on you getting good. Like an Acolyte of Pain here that gets to draw might bring back the warrior, but it's a big sequence of ifs. Alright, Dr. Boom's out. Let's see what Zelly picks up to deal with it. I'm not sure exactly if there's anything left. There's an Execute, possibly.
Oh, that's pretty good. Maybe two cards, if it doesn't die to the Boombot.
It doesn't die, and it gets you two armor. How sick is that? Oh, wow! Oh,
there's a Brawl!
Okay. Well, now we're talking. Zelly with the Brawl Patron. That's something you don't see every day. Thank you, Savitz, for this marvelous list.
Surprise. Yeah. There is not going to expect that Brawl at all, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I really like Zelay's decision to hold the Brawl, because you know that even if you Brawl this turn, you know, next turn there's more minions. You have to, like, play for value, I guess, and try to Brawl for more things so you can kind of get a couple more turns to draw into more of your combo cards. But, yeah, against these two minions, Brawl doesn't do that great.
Yeah, so I guess you'd have to go for, like, Warsong Commander. Do you start with? You can't start with the Brawl. It doesn't make sense, right?
I think you might be dead here if you don't Brawl, though. Oh, he just passed. Yeah, well, he's dead. So.
A bold play, but yeah, sometimes you gotta make those bold plays to actually win the game.
Well, Trude takes it.
It was a pretty good game, so Naria's gonna be grabbing that win, actually, which is going to seal the deck for him, and no more worries about having to queue into the mage. That's taken care of.
Yeah, yeah, huge win by Liquid there.
Changed the dynamic of this matchup a lot. Now Team Liquid's like has a commanding lead, 4-2, with two of their last decks being pretty strong decks.
Yeah, there's the Snake Trap Hunter that we saw from Show earlier, and there's the Mage from Naria that we still don't know what it is, but we have to expect Freeze Mage, right? I mean, Naria's been playing quite a bit of that in the past. It's one of the players that I pin on that deck specifically. Although I might be wrong. Maybe he's going to play, you know, Grinder Mage. Because why not?
I don't think so.
It'd be nice, though, to see some Grinder Mage in tournaments. Although, it's one of those things where, you know, when I remember the era of Mail Mage that lasted about a week of tournament play, and by the end of every match, the casters were not only, you know, they didn't only sound tired, but you could tell they couldn't possibly cope with the idea that the last man standing format would go through, like, Mail Mage for days.
Yeah.
Those were good times.
Wonder why it couldn't have been that strong. I think it's just, like, people get baited by other people, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Like other people were playing until everyone finally realized just like how bad it was.
Yeah, it's like Hobgoblin Paladin. Everybody's like, oh my god, look at me, man. I'm playing Savitz's deck and he piloted the legend. Then you play it a few games, you're like, how the hell did Savitz ever make that work? That doesn't seem consistent at all.
A lot of decks are strongest at the very start when you make them, because a lot of times you have this surprise factor, you know, the alpha. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
the alpha factor, but you know, once people start realizing what your fatigue deck is, it's kind of a, especially a deck like that, there's a lot of weaknesses. So
yeah, It's interesting because I remember Patron when it initially came out looked totally different than it does now. Like it got refined a lot, and initially people were saying, you know, the deck was pretty much like perfect from the start. Like this deck is unbeatable. The new Patron lists came out that just made it, you know, sort of obsolete right off the bat.
Yeah, a lot of the current Patron lists are even like kind of specialized at fighting against other Patron Warriors. You know, they a lot of them are running Harrison Jones. And a lot of them are designed to combo as early as possible with like the double inner rage and, you know, a lot of cycle before turn five. Because Patron Warrior against Patron Warrior often comes down to who can get out the most Patron Warriors the fastest, because the other player doesn't have Brawl and you can't really clear patrons with patrons because they just kill you one shot. So it seems like a lot of the current lists are specialized in the mirror as well. Hunter against Mage.
I've
seen shows Hunter already.
Yeah, we haven't seen Firebat's Mage, but again, that's a player that I pin on Freeze Mage, kind of like Nerea. I mean, there's a few players that I assume will be playing that deck, like Nerea, Dog, Firebat. Like, those are three players that I'm going to pin on Freeze Mage most of the time.
Wow. Almost the perfect Mage hand against Hunter.
Yeah.
Even has
missing an Ice Barrier.
Yep. That's a good answer, though. We're going to see if Show decides to put out the trap to protect the Juggler here.
I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah.
He definitely has to put out the trap here to protect the Juggler. That's the only reason why you'd play Juggler over your Mad Scientist on turn two, to coin it out, because it's not exactly rare for your opponent to have a Mad Scientist. It's
actually that was a really interesting play. Wow.
Yeah, letting it
that's
sit
a 100% sure you have to make that play, because Doomsayer like should be played oftentimes as early as possible against Hunter, just to get you that tempo, especially with a follow-up of minions like Firebat does next turn.
Yeah, but even worth it to hold the freezing trap and not just return the Scientist. You want the secret that much.
It looks like he does. I mean, getting two Ice Barriers is the best way to guarantee a win, I guess, against Hunters. And then the heal buff can be sprinkled on top to help if you're running it. But I guess that's the reasoning behind Firebat's decision to really just get
the Ice Barrier. Possibly never procs the trap, actually, because of the Eaglehorn bow. Like, you just never attack with any minion for the rest of the game.
Until he punches it out.
Until you're ready, you know, maybe like a heal bot or something. I'm not sure. Like, I don't expect him to attack this turn.
Getting a lot of cards. That's what you want. Card draw early. But now he's got to get the non-card draw cards.
Yeah, now he needs...
the non-card draw cards. So there's like two separations. There's one set of cards that draws you other cards, but you don't want to draw those cards with your card draw cards, right? Totally that makes sense. Point. I'm sure you're right. Yeah. Well, that's 8 health.
You want to use your hero power every turn at this point as the Hunter.
Yeah, it's only one additional damage and you're looking to space it out. Mm-hmm. No Infiltrator, though.
It's actually pretty surprising, but he's playing around Blizzard, I guess.
But with this small board, you're playing around it?
Okay. Yeah, exactly.
I guess Show is really playing.
You don't even bait out the Blizzard because you can just ping the 2-1 and play a secret or AI. I don't know. It feels like it's a little bit too conservative.
It's also like a visionary play. The show is anticipating that this game is going to last another like maybe 5 turns, in which case he'll find some time to play it with less minions on the board.
Yeah, second Frost Nova is pretty good here for Firebat. Allows him to not worry about wasting the first one too much. Although he does have the Blizzard on like worst case scenario. I think he's fine board-wise. It's just that he's going to have to handle the minions that come his way. Now, if you're into, like, if you've got the Leprenome up as show, do you ever just play it right away? Because you can play it when the opponent's so low on life they have to AoE and then die.
I would say on this turn you want to play Leprenome, because this turn you're really, well, if you want to play any minion, it has to be Leprenome here. Like, what you're saying has some merits, but at this point, if you play your Worgen, it's too weak to AoE, whereas your Leprenome gets some damage anyways against AoE. Whereas you want to play Worgen as a singular minion, so like, say next turn you get AoE, then you play your Worgen. At that point, Worgen isn't really enough to bait out an AoE, and he can't just ping the Worgen, so...
Yeah, Show gave a lot of thought to even not playing the Leprenome there, and I thought it was reasonable not to, because if you're not going to play the Infiltrator there, the last turn, expecting AoE, then yes, the Leper Gnome does do a death rattle to damage, but maybe you can get even more out of it.
Yeah, like a kill.
You can start the board with something like Leper Gnome Worgen Infiltrator.
Mm-hmm. Vraba has to think like how important it is for him to use extra mana here, because he can Blizzard to clear, but he also has an option of Frost Niveling and doing a little bit like something that's kind of important. It's just, you know, he doesn't have anything great to do with 4 mana. He could develop his Ice Block. I'm not sure if that's enough. There's also a small thing where if you Blizzard... Oh, no, there's already a secret, right? I guess there's two secrets in his deck. I don't know. Like, if you expect that there's a Snake Trap, you might not want a Blizzard just because it thins out their deck a little bit for traps. Like, you don't want to draw those traps as Hunter. You know, maybe you want to wait longer, Frost Nova, and hope they top deck that dead card, like the Snake Trap, but...
Yeah, I think Farbaz looking for that heal bot before he even thinks about getting off the... Oh, wow. All right. So the non-beast kill command. So does that actually...
That's a mana curve consideration, right?
Yeah, probably. Right, I mean, it helps set up for the pop block if one comes out.
Yeah, I can't play everything next turn. Oh, and Sho is trying to kill Farbaz before Alexstrasza here, or at least get the block before Alexstrasza.
Also trying to play around Frostbolt to face, I guess, or Ice Lance to face.
Mm-hmm.
Farbat is wondering where the Healbots are.
Yeah.
Where's the Alex? Healbot. Yeah, Healbot Alex.
If he doesn't get the Healbot, he's going to have to block and Frost Nova this guy.
Oh, double block.
Is this a good turn to proc the trap?
I want to say yes, personally. Let the pain speak to me. What if it's explosive? I mean, you'd get two card draws and possibly mill yourself, but you know there's a snake and there can't be anything but a freezing. Alternatively, even if it's hybrid, although... Oh, man.
There's actually another reason why you might not want to ever proc the trap, and that's because of Quickshot. So say their hand is Quickshot and Freezing Trap. If you never proc the trap, then they can't actually play the last Freezing Trap to cycle a Quickshot.
Good point. Great point, actually. Very, very good point. That's something I wouldn't have thought about like right off the bat. But when I'm a hunter, I would probably get stuck with a trap in my hand and then realize it later. That's typically what would happen. I'd be like, oh, crap. What's that Quickshot doing?
Well, he has to do it now. He has to do something now.
Something needs to be done. Like, something needs to happen right now.
Yeah, it's probably going to be Blizzard Ice Block, and you just don't have enough time to win. I mean, I guess you would reason that that's what you would have to do, but then you would realize you can't win doing that, so you have to think of some clever way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. It's weird.
Imagine the Leper Gnome being played here. Like, this would be beautiful. This is the kind of situation that Leper Gnomes just... They're so perfect. Man, you're really close to losing this. It all comes down to what Firebat top decks, basically. He's gonna get one card draw here, possibly find Healbot or Alex. Alright, he's got two draws, I think, right? With a Loot Hoarder ping.
Just lose your block at two.
Yeah.
Well, it all comes down to Alex's turn. If there's no Alex's turn, there's no way he wins, actually, right? Healbot is not actually enough, is it?
Healbot wouldn't be enough to save him, I don't think. Oh my god.
Actually,
okay.
It kind of is.
It would be just enough because he can Ice Lance or Frostbolt.
Top deck Alex next turn still.
And is he just shooting himself in the face? Yeah, and he is. Alright, Fireback. So Team Liquid gets a 5-point complete, like 3-point lead on Team Archon at the moment. Like 5-2. They're one game away from getting it. It's just that simple.
Had a heal bot got one deck. Game. The proper play would have been to Loot Hoarder or Fire Blast and then try to fish for it.
And then Ice Lance Misha, if you find it.
I mean, like, I guess when you look out the game as a whole, you can't actually win against the Hunter from that point.
Yeah.
Well, no, maybe you get Alexstrasza shortly after and then you...
But you assume you're dead, I guess, because of Misha. Because you had 9 mana, so you can't play the Ice Lance on top of... Loot Hoarder ping Healbot. So you're on 10 and there's 6 on board against a hunter that you think is running aggressive things. I mean, Firebat's known. I've seen him do that a lot. You know, when he thinks the game's lost, he just, you know, escapes. That's it. He's just out of it. Doesn't bother going through the motions when he thinks he's lost it. And now that's one mage left Frenaria to win with, and then they might be able to seal a really convincing series here.
Yeah, they need this win too to basically try to, you know, not win the race for last place.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's not just the race for last place, too, because every single win you get advances your position further on in the league. So there's a big incentive not to get last place, but there's also pretty good incentives to not be seventh and sixth.
So if Nerea's playing Freeze Mage, I assume you have to queue Patron and Warrior. Like, there's no reason not to. If the assumption is that Nerea plays Freeze, that's probably the better matchup that they've got.
I guess, so, interestingly enough, this matchup's not as lopsided as people might think. You know, maybe if you think Warrior is like a free win. Like, I don't know, like a lot of people say actually Freeze Mage is favored in this matchup. Sometimes, I'm not sure, but I think the version that Zelaya plays relative to, for example, a version with Grom is a lot worse. Because, you know, more tempo-oriented version with Grom is very powerful. This is a very combo-based version of Patron, and it doesn't work against Ice Block that well. You generally want to just throw out minions as tempo against Freeze Mage as Patron Warrior instead of like saving everything to do like a huge turn, because of, you know, it doesn't actually matter that much because of Ice Block, even if you do that. So did he keep Fireball in his hand?
No, he tossed it. He only capped
Arcane. Okay, that would be really weird. Brawl as well, which is kind of a dead card in this matchup, I'd say.
That's right. That makes it a little bit worse. Shield Block, that's a good card in the matchup.
Yeah, probably one of the better ones, in fact.
But I feel like it actually doesn't matter that much, the Shield Block, because without the actual Grom in this deck, it feels like this version. And I've seen Nerea play Freeze Mage in this matchup. He oftentimes plays it as a complete control class where you try to fatigue out the warrior and win the very, very long run. So oftentimes it doesn't actually come down too much about how much armor the Patron Warrior has, rather it comes down to whether the Patron Warrior can even kill you.
Wow, there's shield blocks.
Is this Patron Warrior?
This is a patron that expects Team Archon to be playing. What?
No,
I don't even know if it's patron. Like, I don't think this is patron. It looks like Control Warrior with like unstable ghoul inclusion see. Mm-hmm. Is Nerea playing control? Because is Zelaya playing control? No, we saw him play earlier. There's no way
Zelaya is patron.
It wasn't for the fact that we've seen him play before. Then okay.
Yeah, there's no way Zelaya's just switched decks mid series.
There's no way it's possible. You can just YOLO it.
Accidentally just queues into, like, plays another deck.
Yeah.
He's like, sorry, guys.
On the topic of armor, though, can't you win with Patron Warrior just by gaining a lot of armor?
Yeah, you can. It really depends how the game plays. And if you want to win with a lot of armor, you need to make sure not to draw too many cards with Battle Rage, because, you know, often, like, this matchup, it's not obvious who draws faster through their deck, and one good thing about the Patron Warrior is you can kind of control that. So if you do want to win through a ton of armor, I mean, I guess now that we see two shield blocks, that makes it much more possible than, you know, without it. I guess Lay really wants to think about that and maybe not to get gigantic battle rages, because if you do get gigantic battle rages, you're gonna fatigue way faster. So at that point, it doesn't even matter how much armor you have.
Yeah.
You're like, say, 7 cards or 6 cards ahead of them. It's way too much damage from fatigue.
Okay, so he's kind of happy here. He managed to lose 1 health. That's a big deal for Battle Ridge.
Yeah.
The Armor Smith.
I wonder if Nerea could even think of just start pinging the Acolyte. I guess
just
it doesn't
to force his opponent to draw as much as possible. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I could see that.
Yeah, that's That'd a little bit too though. Early for that decision.
Too early, yeah, I agree. It's too early.
Yeah. Late game's good, but
Liz at 8 cards in hand might have to be starting to worry about this Acolyte and overdrawing.
Another thing is that if you do want to go for a fatigue game as war, you know, go for the super light armor game, you need to actually think about how to kill Doomsayers, because oftentimes the Froststone Doomsayer are pretty scary board, and if you just execute it, you can easily lose to the big minions.
Like you actually like an Archmage, and then you can't deal with it. Yeah.
Yeah, or Alexstrasza if it just keeps hitting you for 8 and you can't deal with it.
So Leia briefly thought about armor upping versus probably the other choice of shield block, so it seems like to some extent he's thinking about going for the very long game of the armor.
Yeah, it makes complete sense just farball here. There's it's like you might want to Alex them, but if they have like more than 6 armor or 7 armor, you might as well farball. And your hand is getting pretty clunky. This matchup you almost never farball anything else anyways, so like you're mostly clearing the board through AoE.
Isn't that also a little dangerous to use the fireball when there could be a Thorsand coming up, though? Because I don't see an answer from Nyria's hand.
But Zalae just passes turn 6. I think that's a huge consideration as well. Because on turn 6, I feel like he would have played Emperor if he had it.
Yeah, you would have probably seen it right away just to get some value out of it and force an immediate fireball or some kind of Frostbolt Iceland, see if you have it. If you don't, then at least he's getting something done.
Yeah, sometimes if you want to play the long run with armor game, oftentimes people choose to play both their armor smiths together. Wow, I almost feel like he's putting himself kind of all in with this, playing one armor smith and not even whirlwinding. I guess he has a death bite, which he didn't even use, so if you go flame strike here, you're not getting much armor anymore.
Alright, so I guess Emperor is actually probably better since you've got double Frostbolt with the Ice Lance. Never mind actually like blizzarding this board ever.
That was kind of like using the coin also for Armorsmith, so I don't think it's different. Although there was a big consideration to getting rid of cards in hand.
That's actually a big worry, you're right. Like if he starts overdrive, that's one of the things I guess that really makes those slower matchups bad. Like I was casting a live event in Montreal recently, like on Monday, and there was a point in a Freeze Mage versus Patron game where the Warrior just battle raged and drew like 5 cards that just he didn't need to do because he was going to draw them eventually. And that ended up being the deciding factor where he lost it in the end. So I guess overdrawing is a real possibility.
The Acolyte tends to be good, but you have too many cards. And the Patron is like, it just commits a lot, but I think it's worth it just for the armor. That's a lot of armor. That's pretty good.
Inner Rage is actually pretty good here, I feel, because you can kill the Thorzon with your
Acolyte.
Not anymore,
yeah. I was going to say, if you want to do it, you'd have to do it first. Maybe
Gnomish.
Yeah, well, Execute could help a bit, I guess.
I don't feel like you want to
Execute. Although, you could slam and trade one of them. That's probably good enough. Right? Oh, wow. Or trade.
Alright. One thing that I think I have heard from the grapevine about Zalae is he really likes Inner Rage. He likes saving it for the most important moment possible.
I mean, when you have 46 health against a Freeze Mage that you know is trying to 1-2 punch you, and you've got to feel comfortable. I mean, that shield block was an extra 5, the other one's an extra 5, and that's a lot of damage that the Freeze Mage just doesn't have until they get Archmage with at least, you know, 4 more fireballs in a position like this one. It's kind of weird.
Not often I see a Blizzard on Patrons.
Yeah. No Blood Mage Thalnos either, so...
I don't think Nuria had, like, a great answer, unfortunately, so... Not unless he was willing to use his frost bolts or something.
Double shield block. Nerea seeing the second shield block here must be wondering what on earth that brew of warrior is. Because we saw one in the earlier game with Zalae involved, but we didn't see the second one.
You know, in a way, shield block, even though it's like intuitively it makes so much sense that you can just out armor them, shield block also cycles through your deck in this matchup. Like, you know, you have like it's a card that doesn't provide any power as far as killing them or having a board, and it forces you to cycle through your deck even more. So I wonder if we look at these cards, like, because that's actually something really important, like how many cards each player has in their decks left, because that'll change the dynamic of this game a lot. 11 cards for the Warrior, 13 for Mage. So Warrior's 2 cards ahead right now. A lot of his cards are like mandatory cycling, like the Acolyte in his hand, he can't play pretty much forever in this game, I guess. But
yep,
the battle rages and the
slam's gonna have to be used to kill something, like maybe even this loot hoarder, so it doesn't draw a card.
So I feel like it's a good opportunity to get rid of a slam, right? Because you want to use your slams without cycle, and like you can only have 10 cards, right? So you have to use something here. Yeah, okay. So it does decide to do that.
Yeah, this is interesting because we're seeing kind of the really obscure alternate win condition for Patron Warrior here, which is going to be it looks to be a win by armor.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least a plan to win by armor.
Yeah.
But do you think here, I mean, Flamestrike is pretty much the obvious play. Alternatively, you could try out like a Blizzard Doomsayer. I don't think it'll work out ever. You could ping Patron, Blizzard. It's just kind of weird.
I don't know. Rear continues his plan from earlier. He's been just fire blasting these patrons to create one less patron.
There's going to be Doomsayer played here. And there it is. You know, I like that. That's pretty cool. Goodbye, Patron. So one Ice Lance less for Archmage Antonidas, though. This is a way to save his
Flamestrike. Unfortunately, he does have to use an Ice Lance for this. Makes his Archmage a lot weaker. So
yeah, that's my biggest worry for that Ice Lance, I guess. Like, the fact that it's not going to be available when you need to play Archmage Antonidas with double Frostbolt, possibly one or two Ice Lances.
Oftentimes, really Freeze Mage is only running one Flamestrike, and you say if you can find a way to deal with the patrons like in a cute way like this, you can save the Flamestrike for the second wave of patrons.
So. Right.
Well, looks like Zalay wants an answer because he doesn't have any.
He's just throwing this away, it feels, into the Doomsayer.
No, just throw it away, okay.
Uh-huh. Mage is bringing this, I guess.
I actually really like that move. So
that's pretty good.
You kind of have to throw it away, otherwise you're just going to lose because you drew too much. I would have even double Battle Raged here just to throw it out of my hand. Like, goodbye. Then you end up cycling them with one health off.
He had two patrons at one.
Yeah, that's right. So he couldn't have done it. You're right. Has to wait. Double Battle Rage would draw you two cards still, though. So you're still paying to cycle. And I don't think that's anything he's looking to do here.
Mm-hmm. Theoretically, Zalay still wants to proc the block or earn pressure as well. But he's really not able to do that until the Ember draw field. Because you need the Ember to make...
We actually have a problem here. We don't have any cards that we can play. Oh,
well, you can play one Frothing to force the mage to deal with it. It's a Frostbolt ping.
I mean, actually the button doesn't light up if there's no minions.
Yeah. He didn't want to play any cards, but he had to.
Mm-hmm.
This is really weird. I think Zalay is definitely going for the win by fatigue. Like, that is the obvious plan.
Now that he's played
the Frothing,
he's left himself with absolutely no choice but to do that.
Yeah.
Wow. And also, Nuria is using a lot of these spells, so Nuria might actually have a hard time killing this warrior, because it seems like his Archmage is not actually going to get that many fireballs.
Well, to be consistent, now I imagine Zalay plays Frothing here.
Whoa. All right, what were you saying, Trump?
To be consistent, I imagine Zalay plays Frothing here. There it is.
There's actually no longer only has one fireball from Archmage. It's probably this game. Oh, no, two with Ice Lance. Okay.
So he still has one Grim Patron, so that's probably going to be his last bit of burst. He'll save the Inner Rage, the Patron, the Warsong Commander, the Whirlwind. He'll be able to do something at least 14.
Still no Emperor.
Might be a one-turn kill with Patron. That'll be fun.
Yeah.
You could double Battle Rage and hope you find it. Because, there's... Like, you Battle Rage once, you draw one card, and then you can play Emperor then and there. Or you can draw two cards and try to find the Emperor, and if it doesn't work out... I mean, I guess, what do you do if it doesn't work out?
The larger problem here right now is that he doesn't have any cards that he can play.
Yeah.
That he wants to
play. Or Inner Rage, right?
Ugh.
The problem is Inner Rage is 5 damage, which is a lot. It actually possibly is 8 damage.
In certain circumstances, yeah.
But if you're going for a win through fatigue, that it doesn't matter as much, right?
Yeah.
So he doesn't want... It is very helpful to bring your opponent down to one.
Yeah, that's true.
I like the Warsong Commander play. Like, that looks ridiculous, but he does have enough fun in his deck.
Yeah. And now, I guess Neria's holding on this Flame Strike in case a Patron comes out, which it does. Wow, all right. So, hello, Patron.
It's worth it to play it here, because you're going to play it eventually.
You actually have the Warsong already. You don't even need Emperor here, because you already got the discount on the Warsong, technically, right, from last turn. Could actually maybe get the bulk here. I don't know the math too well here.
It's going to be two patrons at 5, and then 4 patrons at 3, so 10 plus 12, 22. Yeah, you can break the block pretty easily here.
Something to think about, though, why he's not playing patron.
Whoa, he chooses
something
not to break
the block. If you use both Enrages and your Death Spite to get the block, you might not have a way to proc execute on a big minion.
I'm not sure you needed to use the Death Spite. Let's see, so it's 24, 26... I don't think he even needed the Death Spite.
Oh, okay, Neria's plan is looking very foreign to me. So he's really planning to just play the Fatigue game as well. And he really holds on to that Flame Strike for the very last second when all when both Warsongs are dead, which will happen very soon, and the Patrons try to come out with a last-ditch Whirlwind Inner Rage effort, which has to be now, I guess. If you want to pull that off. There's really no other time.
I was very surprised that Zalae didn't do it last turn, but...
Yeah.
He has another Armor Smith in his deck, doesn't he?
Oh, I see.
Oh, wow.
That must be his plan.
You're right. So he's just waiting for that last Armor Smith to get all the patrons up with a ton of armor with the whirlwind from the weapon. All right. Seems to be... It's very consistent with his game plan from what we've seen so far.
It's time to slam!
Yeah, actually, you're right. That's amazing. Oh, wow. That's beautiful. But now there's really no enabler for Archmage. Healbot.
Interesting. Does that mean that Nari is saving the... Alex to heal himself as well, maybe?
That's what I'm thinking. If he hasn't been using it offensively, I mean, there might be a point where it becomes useful offensively.
Yeah.
But it's not yet.
Okay, it's a good pickup, finally. Maybe it means that he leaned up the heal bot, though, because this whirlwind is too important. This whirlwind from Death Spite is too important, right, for the last Armorsmith. Are you just Emperor? Oh, no.
So, less Armorsmith value.
Yeah.
By default, but at least he can replay that weapon. You know, none of these patrons has charge, which could be pretty big.
Oh, he has another Warsong in there, so it's all good. What a fascinating way this matchup was played.
There's Armorsmith. In fact, it's very likely that this turn is the Armorsmith turn, because if you have to slam execute that or punch it for 5, you take a lot more damage. Whereas since you already have, like, if you whirlwind here, you can also proc execute, right? It's like a killing two birds.
Yeah, yeah. So you're doing everything at once, and mm-hmm.
And it's not like you could ever charge out the. Well, actually, you could charge out the Grim Patrons with the Armorsmith.
Yeah, that's a consideration not to. It this turn
and maybe inner rage execute might be fine.
Inner rage execute or punch,
yeah,
punch
I like that.
I don't think you want to slam execute. Oh, you don't even have slam anymore.
Extra yeah, it's one. Gone.
That's
you
right.
Slammed your own 2-1 or 4-1 at that point, I guess. This is an amusing game. I mean, you like Zelia at this point has to have done the like arithmetic sequencing on the amount of fatigue damage that's going to be dealt to his opponent. By the time
you just play it by ear, I don't think anyone's done the arithmetic sequence.
Well, I mean, if you're gonna go for a fatigue plan at this point,
well, you just
I think
generally
you kind of
have
to
generate as much armor as you can, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just hope it works that way. I'm almost out of cards. Where is that? Is that it? Harrison Jones.
Best minion ever. It's actually not even half bad here, which is funny.
Imagine how good Grom would have been this game, just to have.
This actually didn't work out that well, since the Armorsmith only has one Whirlwind to go with it.
Yeah.
But
that's why I almost feel like it was.
You can't even charge the Grim Patriot to do that much.
And just tank the anti heal bot that turn.
Yeah, he like his last card is Warsong. I guess you can play it with one patron, but at this point, it's like I think you're just gonna wait your entire game.
I think you do it at the exact turn where he plays Alex, because then you can combo Whirlwind with Execute.
Yeah, you don't have the choice.
Also, you can do it on a turn where they're gonna lose their block, but I guess he can't do 30, right? Anyways. There's no way.
Right, might as well do it now then.
Yeah
there's well no way he does 30.
Because if you get the block with it, that makes sense where you one-shot him through the block. Nah, he's
after this turn, Zlay will literally only be armoring up for the rest of the game.
Yeah. But I mean, Ward doesn't have anything else to do either.
This is really amusing. So,
is there another minion here? No, right? There's no minion left for Ward.
There's no card in this deck. Though. Yeah, there's nothing
left. There's not any more big minions. Maybe it's going to come down to the Armorsmith beatdown. Or the Acolyte of Pain beatdown. You know, like you flame strike clear everything and then you play double Acolyte, and if they can't clear Acolytes. No, there's a Fire War Axe. So
war by attrition. But then again, if he keeps the charges.
There's also a wall.
Yeah, you're right.
There's ways to remove the Armorsmith beatdown.
Oh, wow.
Alright, well, this is it. We'll see what happens because this is pretty much it.
Yeah, but like the warrior has quite an edge. The thing
there's
is,
there's no
that
way mage is winning, right?
Yeah.
Right. Warrior one.
It's not even close.
I mean, I guess you can play Blood Mage and Acolyte, like the both of them. Mm-hmm. But then you're exposing yourself to the Brawl. If you know that Zelay is running it, then you're not doing that.
Even if you don't know there's Brawl, if you play Acolyte, he also just punches them, and you
die.
Fatigue damage.
You just die faster. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, you this is over, right? Also, the war hero power is better than the mage hero power in this situation, because he gets two, you do one damage a turn. Not to mention, you know, you're so far behind a life already.
I like this opportunity.
Should I guess?
To resident sleep. Hey, that's crazy, man. You can play Acolyte next turn and then draw again and then replay the other Acolyte to beat down the warrior by one. Okay. No, so that is
not
it.
That's way too slow. You're dead.
Neria can't cope with the fact that his ice blocks won't save him from fatigue damage. So Zell's going to be going up three wins, I guess, for the Team Archon. Team Liquid still has to win with Freeze Mage. And I think at this point, everybody knows exactly all the cards that are in that Freeze Mage's deck. Yeah. No surprise. No Malagos surprise, basically.
Nope.
Wow, that was long.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in those matchups, once you have a plan, like, you know, once both people have locked in their game plan for the game there, it's not incredibly technical play. It's more like just seeing the big picture there and, you know, seeing that you can win through fatigue. Just because, like, you know, a lot of turns ended up just, like, armor pass and, you know, just ended up not doing much of anything. But these games, because these decks are just so... Both of them are so uninteractive. There's not much to do between them. So,
yeah, but it does take a visionary to plan
it's more about
that
seeing that
particular play. From I think Zelay decided to
like
do that
seven?
From somewhere around turn six, maybe.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was ridiculously early in the game, and then he went through with it until the end. That was pretty insane. Good thing he didn't wait for the second Armorsmith, by the way, because that was way down at the bottom of the deck. Like we mentioned, usually some people like to wait for two Armorsmiths to start whirlwinding, but never mind that.
It was dangerous, though. There wouldn't have been, like, just say you wait for 30 turns. Like, one bad thing is you would have had to somehow play out one more card in your hand, you know, because you have 10 cards. But otherwise, it would still be better to just wait and get the double Armorsmith dream, I think.
Yeah.
Here
by the
go.
Way,
next matchup on the block, the mech shaman.
One question before we move into the game. Do you know if the fallen hero card from the mage that you played yesterday that deals more damage with your hero power will increase the damage you take from life tap if you get it from a shredder?
Your hero ability deals one more damage. I think it would.
Okay. All right, that's kind of out of the way. It's also above to Hunter. All right, good. Now back to the to the Shaman versus Mage game. Looking at Freeze Mage versus Mech Shaman. I think Mech Shaman is not that terrible. I mean, it's hard to get the board if the Doomsayer comes out and there's a clean sweep. But Fairy versus a pretty, you know, annoying minion to deal with as a mage.
Well, that's a cool call. He's chosen to keep Doomhammer in his opening hand.
I think it makes sense, actually, now that I think of it. Yeah, makes a lot of sense. Guaranteed damage output. Can combine it with... The earlier you can get your Rockbiters with it, the better off you'll be.
And that's a very burn-heavy hand from Nair. It's all burn.
Double Doomhammer for Zelay here. Whoa! I swear, Neria will not be expecting this. This will be a surprise. We're talking about guaranteed 32, right?
That's right. There's nothing that the mage can do to disrupt 32 damage. Over 8 turns? You
know, I don't know. Well, 8 turns after turn 5. Like, that's a lot to think about, but... I mean, the shaman...
His hand. Like, wait, is this a mech shaman? Oh, yes, it is. Okay.
Yeah, Zap-O-Matic's kind of the telling point.
Nairia must look at that turn 3 and be like, ha, I won.
Two Doomhammers.
Yeah, I don't think... Nairia doesn't know what's about to hit him, you know, 16 times in the face. But
Doomhammer's really good at fighting against, like, these uninteractive decks because, it's, you know, it just does its thing, like, over... Yeah.
Well, I remember it being good.
You can freeze all you want. I just have this Doomhammer that pretty much like never goes away.
Yeah, like it was good against Control Warrior back in the days. But even they could get Harrison Jones value out of it. So you know, nowadays, I guess Freeze Mage is probably one of the best targets for it.
Yeah. It's actually a decent hand against Freeze Mage now. I think about it because it'd be nice to have an early opening, but. It's not that bad. As Shaman, you still get the totem up and generate some pressure from totems. Even though they don't care, I guess, about the totems, they're 0/2s, but...
This is going to be amusing, because I think this might be the worst possible Shaman hand which can beat a deck.
Yeah, like, you're right.
This opening can only beat Freeze Mages, what you're saying.
Yeah.
You can't fight against anything else in this kind of opening, but... I kind of agree with that.
The most unexpected good hand. Well, then again, he could just die to burn, right? Like, if Nairia manages to get an Emperor, let's say.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he picked the second Ice Lance, so that's already 11 plus 6, which is 17.
Yeah.
Oh, and Pyroblast for 27.
Yeah, we're talking about a lot of damage.
This hand would have actually done really poorly against like a Mad Scientist opening, or especially like multiple small minions like Mad Scientist, Loot Hoarder, all burn. This is thinking about somehow removing the Healbot here, because the Healbot is really pressuring your board a lot.
Yeah, I mean, given that his plan is to attack Nairia about, 8 more turns? Yeah. Mm-hmm. He needs the game to go on 8 more turns, so he can't have Healbot doing 24 damage.
Yeah. I wonder. What's the best way for him to remove it if he is going to?
Alright.
Rockbiter's a bit of an overkill, so. But I guess ultimately it's.
I guess you can Rockbiter and just. It's. Yeah. Overkill by 2. That makes more sense than Crackle, probably, right? Because you're still getting the value from the second charge of the Wind Fury here with the Rockbiter. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, Nairia wants to pick up an Emperor here, or Archmage, or both.
This looks so sad from the Shaman side. If not for the second second Doomhammer, it'd be almost hopeless.
Oh my god, Nairia's just smelling blood and going for it. He's like, you know what, never mind this game.
Oh, because he's lethal with Power Blast and turns.
Yeah, he's done with the game. All he has to do is, you know, sit out and wait until
the
Shaman...
Oh, he says Fireball and then coin out Power Blast on turn 10. But is it possible it's possible he's gonna die before then, I think.
Well, the thing is, there's a Doomhammer charge here that can't be used, so that's one turn wasted from Zelay's entire plan, which is gonna slow him down considerably.
Now, I feel.
So you've got the Spellpower Totem, so you just go all in on it. You're like, you know what? 12 damage to face. That's so much damage from
hand. 2 Crackle, 12 damage. I mean, 2 Log Burst, 12 damage. A Crackle, say it's, I don't know. It's random.
Oh my god. I don't even know what... This game is the most ridiculous Shaman versus Freeze Mage I have ever...
It's like a Spell Slinger. It's like a Wizard Duel, right? Yeah. I burned you out, you burned me.
Poker. Like... Wizard Poker, ladies and gents. Live on Twitch. Oh my god.
Is this the Fireball Frost and then return? Hope you survive until Power Blast seems.
And then Zalay top deck. I mean, I think.
Why not Fireball and Frost? Oh, because you clear the Spell Power Totem.
Oh my god, that's game! I don't even know what's happening. You know what? This is just complete madness.
Like I doesn't even crackle, put him on tilt maybe.
Oh my god, he's like, sorry I top deck. But if you see, if you could see his hand area, you wouldn't be surprised by the outcome. I mean, I know you had lethal, you know, 4 turns down the line, but there was a crackle there. Oh man, that was a good game. That was a really cool game.
There are so many really cool games in this series. Like, yeah. There's that Zoo versus Patron, and this right. Freeze Mage Patron. Not only this game. Really oddball ones.
Yeah, I had Insomnia before I watched the Patron versus Freeze Mage, and now I'm kind of cured. The thing I'm curious about is...
I used to play a lot of, like, a Burst Shaman, and it's been kind of going away, but,
yeah.
This was actually not a Burst Shaman, it's more like a Mech Shaman with a lot of Burst, but remember the old Double Doom Hammer Shaman? I guess this is actually really similar, just using, like, a couple of mechs instead, but... It kind of reminds me of that deck. Just keep going face. It's really good against Freeze Mage and Rogue back then when those were an interactive decks. You just go Doomhammer and try to kill them.
Burst was popular a while back, but it couldn't run mechs because they didn't exist.
Yeah.
If you remember, like that wasn't even a thing then. And then when the mechs come out, it just gives you a different minion base to go off of. And you can still sprinkle in that Burst and be even more effective.
All right, Team Archon has decided to go with Freeze Mage versus Freeze Mage as a better matchup than Zoo versus Freeze Mage. Mm-hmm. This one will be the easier of the two.
Yeah, who gets the Emperor?
That's basically a way for you to maximize your points in the league. You always want to, like, if you're gonna, you want to pick up as many wins as you can. So in these situations where you know what your opponent is playing, you always want to queue up your strongest decks first.
Yeah, this another side has a good hand here, but one hand is especially worse. That's the triple secret hand.
I just think it's better.
Because it's got Emperor?
Because
oh wow, it actually got pretty good.
All of a sudden. This matchup is weird because the only cards that really matter are Emperor, Alexstrasza, and Archmage in a way. It's obviously nice to have more draw effects, but I feel like the hand of the Emperor is still better just because you're so much more likely to have it.
And there it goes. Yeah, the Arcane likely beefed that up.
Yeah. Another Emperor.
Okay. It's turned into two bad hands against two good hands.
Yeah.
This is better to watch, honestly. Like, I wouldn't be, overly excited if we saw an Emperor on one side and not on the other, because then it seems like it's super lopsided and when one gets exactly what they need. But this could be interesting. You know, it'll come down to very peculiar turns where people decide to make small bursts with their spells and the other one doesn't necessarily want to do it. I really like those games a bit better.
Maria's hand is not actually too Emperor friendly. Like, the best 5 cards they have with Emperor in this matchup are Archmage and the 2 Frostbolts and the 2 Ice Lances, and he doesn't have any one of those 5 cards with Emperor. So, you know, maybe he doesn't even play it here, just because those are what you're looking to combo Emperor off of. I like the Doomsayer drop here to prevent Emperor on the other side on turn 6.
Yeah. You get the initiative on it, so you're more likely to get it off, and then if they want to deal with it, they have to spend their entire turn doing it.
Really good top deck, though. Strybite actually has a pretty good Emperor hand with 2 of those 5 cards in his hand.
Yeah, but what if, you know, Neria plays as Emperor, then maybe Frostbolt and Ice Lance have to be used right away. In which case...
You have to play Ice Block here. Your Matt's not going to get a secret, actually.
Of course, yeah.
But it wasn't.
But Doomsayer on Lives is an example of like one such small play which can really change the flow of the entire game.
Yeah, and this here, you know, like Firebat will have to handle the Emperor from Nerea if it gets played.
This and is another then, small play right here, choosing not to play.
Oh my god. Okay, well, things might escalate.
Mike's off right now. I feel like I hear something like a lot of static, or could just be me.
I don't hear it.
Yeah, it just went away. Yeah. Oh, wow. That the three of the best five cards just drew the Archmage.
Esports!
And the Archmage is even better than the Frost and Nightstands, because now you have the Archmage to, you know, wow. Such a good draw there.
Yeah, that's why I think going for the Emperor's Guard would have been somewhat okay. Like, I understand you don't have the Archmage, the Frostbolt, the Ice Lances, yeah, right. But you're denying your opponent the ability to tempo you out with it.
Yeah.
Well, that's crazy. Yeah, it's really painful.
Next turn. Unfortunately, Firebat can't play a third spell because he already has two secrets down, so he can't actually play the barrier or the block for the third spell.
That, well, I mean, this is good news for Firebat, though. Lunaria's only answer is Blizzard.
Yeah. Well, I guess he, like, the heal block really helps.
You don't have to kill Alex. You can actually Alex yourself if you want here, because you have a nice barrier anyways. You can just let it hit you for 8. It'll get rid of the barrier, but you feel like it, you know, no other creature will ever hit you for the rest of the game. And technically, like, you don't, you know what I mean? It doesn't actually matter if you just kill the Alex the next turn or start freezing it from then.
That's a good point.
I actually kind of prefer the coin Alex draws in there last turn. Just let it hit you for 8.
And counter pressure, so that you're threatening to pop the block faster.
Exactly.
Oh, I mean, that's getting really dangerous for an area. Yeah,
I like his.
How does he wipe this?
There, I mean, for 7. That way he can leave the block at 1.
So Flamestrike ping, and that's going to give you the kill on the Archmage. And then you're popped, for sure. But then you can heal bot and maybe Alex yourself on the back of it.
Maria definitely has that defensive Alex here with heal bot. But there's just so much damage. And even if you get a defensive Alex, it's not like you win from there. You still have to kill them. Yeah, so.
Oh, wow. All right, that's going to be... I mean, it's a great play. It's an absolutely great play. Playing the Doomsayer on this board denies your opponent the ability to play defensive Alex, and then
still kind of play defensive Alex, right?
Mm-hmm. Or Healbot, I guess, but he dies to Pyro.
So. Yeah, exactly.
Well, he's dead to Pyroblast if he goes for this line of play, but he takes the risk regardless, and that's actually, yeah, the ice block number 2 is going to come out from that Doomsayer, so you know what, he's still going to live and then get the Alex. Wow, that's pretty nice.
It's a little bit weird to power blast at 9 too, because you don't do the damage. It might actually be better not to power blast here.
Yeah, but then it's going to give your opponent the time that he needs maybe to go for an offensive Alex, although you do have the second block.
Well, he'll be defensive, I think, but...
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right.
Oh my gosh, I'm starting to see some kind of strange glow coming from this game where Nyria somehow wins.
Yeah, it's looking like there's a very far away
possibility. I think it's kind of unlikely still. It might feel... Like, ultimately, it comes down, like, this, like, Freezing Age Mirror, it's very mathematical in the sense that each player can only do so much amount of damage and heal for so much. So even though it feels like, you know, maybe Firebat's used a lot of tempo and pressure in a lot of his cards, ultimately, when it comes down to it, let's say you do get the big Alex draws defensively, you know, so what? You know, you still have to, like, you know, it'll still go down to fatigue. You also have to kill your opponent for 30. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't feel like it'll... Yeah, it might be a close game, but it's like not
an
like
Archmage. An Archmage from Nerea would actually seal it, because like Firebat can't use the Acolyte. We know that for a fact. To use, like, you know, to pop the ice block, because there's no way that's gonna fly with the ice barrier up. So he's gonna have to use his spells, but he's only got so many, like, so much burn left. He's got a Frostbolt and an Ice Lance and the Fireball, and now Nerea's definitely gonna go for that Alexstrasza, which puts him out of range of lethal at the moment. So until Firebat gets the Frostbolt. Archmage turn? You know, that would do it.
Oh, Archmage. Yeah.
Yeah, an Archmage turn would actually get Nerea possibly... Like, if Firebat whiffs on getting the second Frostbolt, there's a chance that Nerea can take this.
Actually, looks like Nairia is ahead. Just off of odds. Yes, Firebat can get that Frostbolt, but he needs specifically that card now.
Yeah.
It's a one card out for Firebat.
He has a couple turns, right?
He's quite yeah, he's got a lot with the Ice Block. He's got like five draws, I think. Yeah.
Realistically.
Oh, wow. All right. Well, that's going to help a lot for sure. Now, let's see the Ancient Brewmaster. I mean, the Youthful Brewmaster.
It's a good top pretty deck. Good.
That'd be sick.
Get as many fireballs as possible. It doesn't even go for their Alex.
All right.
Oh, he's getting the block here.
Whoa.
Whoa.
This is really what? Aggressive.
That is way too risky. Well, then again, I guess you're keeping one Frostbolt for the cycle of infinite fireballs, so it all boils down to the same crap, but you're popping the block one turn earlier. So you're forcing him to have the second ice block or the Frostbolt to kill you. And there's a chance he has neither, and then you win. Okay, I could see where it's coming from, but it's actually a great line of play. Like, I would have gone, like, oh, well, that's gonna cut it. That's gonna cut it. Firebat with the fireball, never mind that. Wow, could this be another reverse, like, sweep that we saw last mat, like, last series in the best of 11, and now we see it from Team Archon and Liquid?
Could be.
That's insane.
All in the back wow. of this last
game. That was
game.
So cool. Nairia chose a line of play that was actually giving him the edge, but I can't actually say at any point he was leading, though, because Firebat could have drawn so many cards.
Yeah, with the Arcane Intellect among... Like, at the very end there was a good chance he found... that he found what he wanted. Alright, well, we're gonna see... This is gonna be the last game of the day. It's gonna be Freeze Mage versus Firebat's Zoo that we saw earlier against... I think the Patron from Show.
Yep. They've saved the worst matchup for last, but this is certainly not hopeless by any means. In fact, it's actually really close, I'd say.
Wow, that's a really good hand. Nerubian Egg plus Void Tear. In this matchup, as your most important turns are the early turns. Usually, you want to like play very high power minions early, and then somewhere between turn 4 and 5, you want to spam your Death Rattle minions to play around the AO, like, you know, Doomsayer, basically Frostman with Doomsayer.
Yeah, and he's right, got so already the Frostman with Doomsayer.
Unfortunate right? thing is
this
that.
This is actually perfect. He's going to play Nerubian Egg on 2, and then Power Roaming plus Void Terror on 3. It's actually almost like the best opening possible.
Yep.
Without counting like a flame in turn one as well.
What were you saying, Trump?
It's okay, Strafker said it.
Okay.
That is good.
There's actually one awkward turn for Mage here, because you can't Frost on Doomsayer until turn 5. And you can't really use your Frost on turn 4 just because at this point you're way too far. You'll be too far behind if you use your Frost on turn 4. You actually need to clear this on turn 5. So awkward turn this turn.
Do you play Doomsayer as a healing touch?
Maybe. I don't know. No, I guess not.
I guess not. Alright.
Well, maybe
that's
gonna
solve the,
I don't know.
The quandary. Finale's picked up though. That could be really big for Firebat. Because there's only one Frost Nova.
Yeah.
It's a lot of pressure, but Nairia about to equalize it.
Yep. Super convincingly too. I mean, this Frost Nova Doomsayer is like the oldest combo in Hearthstone, it feels. And it's still viable today. So, like, it's kind of fun to look at.
I want to see Firebat's face here. It's like, this is so demoralizing. Because you're feeling so good until this.
There is.
Please, no owl. Please, no owl.
Please, no owl.
Oh.
Okay. At least you got the creeper.
The trick is to Bane of Doom your own 1/1 so that you spawn a Mal'Ganis or a Doomguard that the mage then has to answer. Or you get a Prothorsten as a mage on turn 6 before you're about to.
Not if it's frozen. Well.
He knows he's dead. Like, doing the math, it's pretty obvious. You're going to get Fireball pinged and Fireball to face and lose right away. So, Firebat's going to concede it, and Nairia's going to seal the game for the entire match against Team Archon. So, Team Liquid going up 6-5. You know, there might have been a possibility of a crazy sweep, you know, reverse sweep coming from Archon, but it didn't happen. Nope. Close enough.
Yep, they tried
These
real
games
hard.
Are coming down so much to the last game.
Yeah, well, it's that's the way this format works in the best of 11. You can see here the standings for the end of the day at the moment. I think they're going to be updated later. I'm not sure if this includes today's matches. Actually, it does, because Team Liquid is now up where it was actually a lot lower on the rankings, closer to Team Celestial. So Team Celestial is still the unfortunate losers of this day with the 4 losses accumulated total.
Yep. So many even, teams that well, not, not even worse for him, but as an added kicker, unfortunately, Team Liquid wins.
For them. So, yeah, unfortunately for Team Celestial, Team Liquid winning means are they pretty much guaranteed not to be able to equalize with any other team?
I'd have to look at the matchups, but yeah. It might be possible for Celestial to win 3, and then all the other, one of the teams of 2 to lose the next 3.
How many games are there total?
7.
Yeah, there's 7 matches total. It's around it's a round robin format, so you're bound to play each other team. So when you have 8 teams, obviously you're getting 7 matches in total, and the last team on the entire list is going to get thrown out in the to go to the playoffs. So unfortunately, I mean, that was a crazy day. The first matches were really good. You know, Tempo Storm just swinging back in with a reverse sweep in the first match versus Celestial. And then we had a really grindy series between Liquid and Archon with really cool games. I mean, I really liked the, Mage versus Patron as much as it might have been slow. That was a really good game, I thought.
Yeah.
All right.
It's coming down to, the last... So many teams are in the running because... Other than Team Celestial, it seems like 3-1s and 2-2s. It's all pretty close with 7 games total. So,
yep,
it's like every team's in the running.
That's gonna be it for the day, guys. I mean, thanks for watching. Before we go, a quick shout out to our sponsors. We have Alpha Draft. If you want to check them out, they're a esports fantasy league. You can bet on matches. You can go there to get yourself a couple cool cash prizes. And you've got the Amazon giveaway that's also happening. Team Archon. .com/Amazon. You can check them out there. You can get a chance to get a 50% discount on 40 Hearthstone packs. It's a promotion on the Amazon App Store, so you can check them out. That being said, thanks for watching, guys. We'll be back next week with more matches. Until then, have a nice one.